Well, happy Friday and welcome everybody. Welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all do me a favor and please love up on Love Jones for me, and please make sure that you like the video on your way in, and don't be afraid to drop down in the chat box and say, hey girl, hey. If you happen to enjoy yourself while you're here, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure to click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the Speakeasy is open for business. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my wonderful brand new sippers and speakers. Thank y'all so much for subscribing to the channel, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my crazy ass returning sippers and speakers, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thank y'all for coming back one more time to love up on your girl, because I can't seem to get enough of the way that y'all love on me. All right, I was absent. Yesterday, I was marked absent. Okay. My little seat was empty, but that's all right though. I'm here now. Why y'all bringing up old shit? You know, the fact that I wasn't here. So let me handle up on a little bit of housekeeping right quick.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money.
All right. Thank you so much, Melly Mel, for the tip. It was a replay tip. And she said, for getting tipsy and falling asleep in the speakeasy. Thank you, Melly Mel. I appreciate you. Thank you so much for the tip. That was from Wednesday's live stream.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money.
And that was for Summer. Thank you so much, Summer. She said, corporate mean as hell, for real. Thanks, Saki. Well, you're welcome, darling. And thank you for the tip. That was from Wednesday as well. Child, we was long gone and over yonder. Oh, chopping it up and talking cash money shit about everything. Ciao. Okay. All right. So let me see who's here right quick. And then, we can get on down because I'm going to give y'all as much of this as I can, child. Because what y'all not about to do is work me like a Hebrew slave. No, ma'am. All right. So first sipper and speaker through the door, Love Jones, annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Naomi was actually the first sipper and speaker. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Miss Tiffany, you are here. Yes, thank you so much. You sure did tell me earlier today that you were coming, and I thank you. Y'all welcome, Miss Tiffany. She is a subscriber over on Being Grace's channel. Y'all know I tell y'all all the time about Being Grace. Make sure y'all go follow her. Her husband is a whole cackle, and she is quite the kiki, and I enjoy their channel. I really do. All right, so thank you for being here, Tiffany. Summer's in the building. Thank you, darling, for being here, lovey, and welcome. I appreciate you. We have a new subscriber here with her first live, Sarah Long. Y'all welcome Sarah here. She said, hey, Saki, I hope I know how to behave. Girl, just act like you're grown. That's all. Just be grown, and you're going to be all right, okay? Hey, Steady said, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Buns is in the building with her badass calling me Saki. All right, I see you. Plus five. All right. Hey, Dior, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And you too, Sherelle. L Boogie is back with us, and she got the church lady right behind her. I almost said something, but let me not. I'm going to behave. I'm like, what the hell y'all got going on? Oh, my God. Okay, DJ Queen Champion, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you being a new subscriber. I found out about your channel through Being Grace. Well, thank you for being here, honey. Y'all welcome, DJ Queen Champion. Thank you and welcome. All right. Hey, Nakia, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Unisha, finally all caught up. Happy to catch you live. Well, we're happy you're here. Y'all welcome, Unisha. Hey, Tracy. Welcome, darling. And you got Netta right behind you, child. And look who bringing up the real wifey. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Thank all of y'all for being here. Hey, Marva. Happy Friday, darling. I appreciate you being here. And you too, Camilla. Child, am I missing anybody? Nope. Chocolate Butterfly is here. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Let me see. Wait. Oh, yeah. I just got Netta. Netta's here. Thank you for being here. All right. Miss Pretty's in the building. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. Shakara's in the building and probably got my best friend sitting right. Oh, she listening. All right. That's what I was about to say. Hey, Tracy Four. Welcome, darling. Thank you, Shakara and your mom. I appreciate y'all being here. Hey, Sean. Welcome, lovey. Thank you for being here. Child, look at all the new people showing up. Thank y'all, child, for dropping down out the chat, child. Oh, wait. Oh, this little mama. Okay. Well, welcome. Girl, you're going to have to change that. Hey, Tina. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. Y'all welcome, Tina. And listen, Camellia, we just going to call her Kim, child. That's a little mama. You got to put little mama before that or something because I ain't going to know who the fuck that is. And you're going to be talking shit. And I'm going to be like, oh, let me block this person. You know, I expect it from you, but I ain't going to know who that is, child. All right. So let me get my time stamp so we can get on down the road. Hold on, honey. I got my time stamp so we can start here. Oh, my word. Hey, Melly Mel. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. You missed your music, child. You missed your music. I don't know what to tell you. You got to red ball it back, but I gave you your music, boo. Yeah, I had to give you music. Oh, God, dog it. All right. Today, we're reading Corporate's Pleasure 3 by Diamond D. Johnson. And the synopsis reads, the finale is finally here. Since part one of this series, this has been one crazy roller coaster of a ride. New enemies have come to tear down the strong organization, and now things have suddenly taken a turn for the worse, as there is now beef within the family. Kyle is a snake that's been lurking in the grass for years. For so long, Corporate has kept him around, feeling that it was something his father and his grandfather would have wanted had they still been in the picture. Kyle has done the ultimate disrespect this time, and Corporate will not rest until he's dealt with. The finale of this series will have you hanging onto the edge of your seat. Corporate and Pleasure's marriage is tested like never before. We can only hope they can stick together through these trials and finish this beautiful journey in their marriage, which sadly has to get ugly sometimes. Oh, my word, child. All right, here we go. So I guess we were just warned to expect some shit, y'all. So, yeah, let's get on down with it then. All right. I'm getting my time stamp so we can start the first chapter, child. I hope everybody had a great week and you're having a wonderful Friday and you're looking forward to a great weekend. Chapter 1, Colony Strong. I swear to God, man, I hate that bitch, Miss Roy. How's she gonna give me a C minus in her class when all semester I've been getting nothing but A's on all of my tests and my homework assignments? My dad is gonna fucking kill me, bro. You know we can't bring home anything less than an A. Hey, Shakayla, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. I could hear this cracker talking outside the shower I was using in the boys' locker room after playing basketball during PE. It was my last class of the day, and the bell should ring in the next 10 minutes or so, dismissing us from school. We'd gotten our interim reports once our PE class was over, and I had all A's, even though I'd only been at school for 3 months. I wasn't surprised that I'd gotten the kind of grades that I did because a nigga was smart. I just had a habit of doing dumbass shit when I was back home in Atlanta, wanting to skip school and shit with my guys and not apply myself. I was one of those niggas who felt like I was too cool for school. But even with that mindset, you could put a test right in front of me after I'd skipped for an entire week, not studied shit, and I bet I passed that bitch. I knew that because it had happened on so many occasions when I was in Atlanta. Math has always been my strong point, though. I think my love for money is what had me advanced in math, because at 5 years old, I loved to count up money. I was the kind of nigga that if you borrowed some money from me, I'd be on your ass knowing the exact amount that I'd given you and wanting my shit back paid in full. The longer you would take to pay me back, I swear I would add interest. Damn, Brody, I gotta be in her class, which is surprising because I always forget to do her homework. Calm down, though. It's not that serious. These are just our interim reports. We still have a while before we get our report cards. Relax, I heard another guy say, and I knew that voice belonged to Connor. It was Brody and Connor talking outside the shower about their grades. They were seniors, but I took a lot of my classes with them. My grades from Atlanta were transferred over to Miami, and they weren't bad. It just showed that I had a lot of absences and tardies, but other than that, I made good-ass grades back home. So all my classes were advanced, and I was taking classes with the seniors. Brody was the kind of person that you could look at and just tell that cracker had mental issues. Rich as fuck, though. Well, his parents were rich as fuck. I knew his dad was an attorney and his mom was a doctor. I only knew that shit because I often heard him boasting about it in class to the other students. With that money came him having nice shit. He pushed a nice-ass Army green Corvette, and Brody was a sneakerhead just like me, so he owned damn near every Jordan and Nike shoe there was. I could tell that he wasn't wrapped too tight, though. I'd seen him talking to himself on numerous occasions. In our history class, we had assigned seats, and I sat right next to him. At times, he just zoned out. He was racist as fuck, too. Probably didn't even know my black ass existed because he never spoke to me or even acknowledged me for that matter. He didn't have many friends from what I could see. Connor was the only person I ever saw him with, and I was convinced it was because others thought his ass was crazy, too. He was always bragging about the money his parents had, so that was probably another reason a lot of people didn't fuck with him. Whatever, man. I'm getting so fucking sick and tired of this place. I hate this damn school. I hate every fucking teacher who works here. I hate the principal, and I hate the fucking kids here, too. I want to act on that plan that I told you about a few weeks ago. I want to shoot this entire school up and then set this fucker on fire, he said. I stood under the water, making a face because he sounded crazier than I thought his ass was. Granted, school wasn't my favorite place to be, but I never had thoughts of shooting this bitch up. If I ever started feeling like that, which I doubted I ever would, I would just stop going altogether. Shit was never that serious to me, though. Yeah, and even when you told it to me a few weeks ago, I said you were crazy for even saying something like that out loud. Brody, listen, all that bullshit aside, would you really shoot up the school because you got a C- on your interim report? Connor, it's not just because of the fucking C-, man. A lot of things play a part in why I would like to shoot this fucking school up. Man, I've been coming here since I was in the 9th grade, and I've been bullied all fucking 4 years. People laugh at me because I look different. None of the girls will give me the time of day, even after my dad bought my Corvette, and I know the teachers even think I'm weird. I hate this place, man. Look, Connor, I have thoughts about shooting this entire school up since my freshman year, but I've always talked myself out of it. I just had enough, and I want to move forward with my plan. Don't worry, I won't let anything happen to you, Brody responded. Oh, God. Yeah, that ain't cool at all, pimpin'. The hell? This is why you have to talk to your children. All right. I could hear the seriousness in his voice, and something told me that his ass wasn't playing. I wasn't no snitch, though, so I wasn't gonna say shit. If anything, I knew where my pop stored a couple of his guns. Just in case Brody was serious about the shit he was saying, I was gonna make sure I packed some heat in my book bag. That cracker had me fucked up if he thought he was gonna air out this whole fucking school, and I wasn't gonna have anything to protect myself. When do you plan on doing this crap, man? I want to make sure that I'm not even in school, Connor said. His ass was just as fucking crazy as Brody. He was supposed to talk that man out of that shit, not find out the dates and shit, and encourage his dumb ass to shoot the school up. Friday. I'm gonna do it this Friday, man. Just then, the bell rang, indicating that school was over. Moments later, it got a little noisy in the locker room, which let me know that others were spilling in there to start changing and shit before going home. Brody and Connor didn't know that I had been in the shower the whole time because I was in the one that was all the way in the back. The two of them were a good distance from me, but I had good ears and I heard every fucking thing. Back when I was living with my mama, she would get on the phone to talk with her friends and shit, and she would turn her TV all the way up in her room. Sometimes she would go outside and talk in the backyard because if she didn't, I could hear her conversation word for word. On some petty shit, I would come around and repeat the entire conversation right back to her. That's just how good my ears worked. On some real shit, though, I didn't know if Brody was serious or if he was just saying that shit out of anger, but I wasn't gonna fuck around and find out. I was bringing my ass to school for the rest of the week, and I would be packing on Friday. I would blow that cracker's fucking head off if he thought he was gonna bring that crazy shit up in there. After my shower, I stepped out after wrapping the towel around my waist that I had brought from home. I went over to my locker, put my coat in, and it popped open. Hygiene was always important to me. I ain't play that shit. I remember being in the third grade and my mama used to take me cologne shopping. I was obsessed with smelling good. The women love that shit too. I pulled out a fresh pair of briefs, some gym shorts, a wife beater, and a top to throw on. After I got dressed, I put my socks on and slid my feet into my slides. I kept my dreads pulled up in the ponytail that I had them in. "Who did your tattoos, man? That shit looks nice," a white boy walked up to me and said. I didn't know his name or anything like that, but I'd seen him around the school a few times. His locker was on the other side of mine, but before he went to it, he stopped to talk to me for a second. "Thanks. I got him in Atlanta. That's where I'm from," I told him, and he nodded. "Oh, cool. My big sister lives in Atlanta. My name's Derek. Nice to meet you, man." He put his hand out and waited for me to slap it up with him. I wasn't the friendliest nigga in the world, but Derek seemed cool, and he gave off a chill vibe, so I reached out and slapped it up with him. "I'm Colony," I let him know. After that, he went to his locker. I put all my dirty clothes in my duffel, grabbed my book bag and one of my math textbooks since I had homework tonight, then closed and locked my locker back before I left. As I walked out of the locker room, I placed my AirPods in my ear, vibing to some old school Jeezy. I walked to the car pickup, knowing that Anders would be there to get me. He would usually be at the front of the line with his hazard lights on because most days I made it out there late. I had to come from the boys' locker room, which was all the way in the back of the school. When I made it out front, I didn't see the Escalade, though. I did see a black Rolls Royce, and I knew it belonged to Pleasure because she had a custom pink tag. She never picked me up from school. Anders or my pops usually came to get me. She had her hazard lights on, and when I swaggered my way over to her car, she unlocked the door for me. I pulled on the handle and opened it before getting inside. She looked over at me and smiled. Pleasure was cool. We had a nice-ass relationship. Our shit started off a little rocky, but we were nowhere near rocky now because our bond really was special. She and I have had some deep-ass conversations where I went in-depth with her about how it was to grow up without my pops in the picture, and with that, I learned a lot about Pleasure in return. She grew up without a father as well. Her mother raised her, who she didn't have the best relationship with. One second, y'all. All right. Pleasure also told me how she moved in with her big mom. Big mom was cool as fuck. She moved in with us a couple weeks ago and her ass be having me rolling with the wild shit that flies out of her mouth. Pleasure treated Big Mom like she was the adult and Big Mom was the child. Because of that, Big Mom was always getting on Pleasure and the shit was comical as fuck to watch. From what my pops and Pleasure told me, Big Mom had suffered a second stroke, and that's why she moved in. They had a nurse who was with her all day, and they even had a physical therapist coming in to get minimal exercise. That's when Big Mom would talk the most shit because she wasn't trying to be doing all of that. "What's good? Where Anders at?" I asked Pleasure after putting my shit in the back seat. "He had a family emergency, and your dad is handling business, so he told me to come and get you." "That's a problem?" she asked. I laughed while shaking my head. "Oh, nah, ain't no problem. I was just seeing what was up," I told her once I was in the passenger seat and had closed the door. Pleasure sat up a little in her seat so she could look out the side window. When the coast was clear, she pulled out of the line, left the car pickup area, turned the hazard lights off, and now she was on the main road. "How was school today?" she asked. I wasn't even going to tell her about that crazy-ass conversation that I overheard while I was in the shower between Brody and Connor. I'd just keep that shit to myself. "It was straight. We got our interim reports today," I told her. As we sat at a light, she turned her head, looked at me, and smiled. "Listen, no disrespect to my pops, because I knew his ass didn't play that shit about his wife, but Pleasure was beautiful as hell. I mean, a natural kind of beauty where she ain't even have to do anything but just sit there, and anyone would be in awe of her beauty. She was my stepmama, so I couldn't crush on her, but all I gotta say is that my pops did his big one when choosing her. It was that jet black bob that she rocked, and I think I appreciated that shit so much because I used to crush hard on Taraji P. Henson back when I was a kid, loving the bob she used to wear, and Pleasure rocked hers similarly. pleasure be dressing her ass off too. Right now, she was wearing a denim romper, and in the backseat was a denim Chanel purse to match her outfit. Big ass diamonds were in her ears, and I knew my pops broke the bank with her wedding ring because that shit was huge. She wore light tennis bracelets and a small chain around her neck. She smelled good too. Oh yeah? I want to see it. How did you do? She gushed. I laughed at her reaction as I reached into the back seat, grabbed my book bag, and placed it in my lap. I went through it, pulled out my folder, and handed it to her. We were still at a light that was taking forever to turn green, so she was able to look at the interim report. Although it wasn't a report card, she still beamed as she looked at it. She looked like how Xavier would have looked had she been the one sitting next to me right now, going over my grades. All my mama wanted from a nigga was for me to make good grades, take my ass to school, and stay the fuck out of trouble. Oh, Colony, you got straight A's. I'm so happy for you. You're in all the tough classes, too, and you're breezing right through them. Did you call your mom and dad yet to tell them? She asked. I laughed at her question while shaking my head. Nah, I'll just show my pops whenever he gets home, I nonchalantly said as she handed the interim report back to me. What about Xavier? You should FaceTime her and show it to her. I know that'll make her happy, she suggested. Yeah, I think about it. You hungry? I'm hungry. That shit they served for lunch today wasn't it. I got money, so it can be my treat, I offered. She giggled as she turned to look at me like, little nigga, I don't need your money. Keep your money, Colony. Where you want to eat? She questioned. Shit, anywhere that's got a good burger, I told her. Pleasure said she knew a spot, and that's where she was going to take us. As she drove, I turned to look at her for a second. Corporate told me you pregnant, I blurted out. What? When did he tell you that? She asked, like she was shocked that I knew this shit. A few days ago. I kind of already knew, though, so I just asked him to confirm. You was loud on the phone with your girls the other day when you was in the laundry room, so I just overheard you when I was in my room. Don't get mad at him for snitching. I kind of caught him off guard when I brought it up to him, I said. I'm not mad at him. I wanted to tell you in a more special way. Your dad and I are having a baby, and you're going to be a big brother. How do you feel about that? She wanted to know. That's good news. I ain't gonna lie. I was a little in my feelings when I first found out about it because I thought that y'all was going to forget all about a nigga and just throw me off to the back burner. But Pops sat me down and let me know how important I was to y'all, so I'm straight. I don't know how to be no big brother, though. I'm gonna let you know that right now. I don't know how to change diapers, put no baby to sleep, none of that. I put his little ass in the gaming chair with me and have him watch me play the game. Oh my God, yo. Typical teenager shit, right? He could watch me play the game. The fuck? All right. I let her know and she laughed. You'll learn. That's why your ass don't need to be out here having unprotected sex. I heard about them females that you got pregnant, she said. I just laughed that shit off, not even wanting to talk about it. After about 15 minutes or so, we pulled up to the sports restaurant that she said had some good burgers. Pleasure parked the car and the two of us got out together. I waited for her to grab her purse from the back seat, and then I let her lead the way while I walked behind her. I learned that signature move from my mama. As a kid, Xavier would always walk behind me, but when I became old enough, I started smelling myself, feeling like I was the man of the house. I would walk behind her, being her eyes behind her head and waiting for a nigga to try so I could beat his ass. That shit just stuck with me, and any woman I cared about, I made it a habit to walk behind them whenever we were out in public. When we made it to the door of the restaurant, I got in front, opened the door, and allowed Pleasure to walk in first. She went over to the hostess stand and let her know that it was just the two of us, and then she walked us to a booth where Pleasure sat on one side and I sat on the other. She handed us some menus and walked away. There were two fine-ass girls walking past, but I had my eyes on the caramel-skinned one with the petite frame. She had light brown hair that was a curly texture, and it went back in two French braids. Her hair was similar to the way my mama would do her hair after she washed it and shit before a hair appointment that would cause her to be in the salon for fucking hours. This girl was so fucking pretty, though. She looked to have been my age, and I fucked with the outfit she had on. It was a yellow and purple collared crop top. She had on a pair of distressed jeans with rips all over them and a tight fit, showing off her small frame. I was a sucker for short girls. I don't know why, but I love that shit. That was how my girl Nani from back home was built. She had these glasses on her face, and I wasn't sure if that was just for fashion or if they had some kind of prescription. I could see her belly button piercing, too, which was exposed by her flat stomach being out in the open. A nice pair of yellow and purple dunks were on her feet. I was sweating her hard, even though she wasn't paying me much attention because her head was down as she looked inside her phone. Don't you have a girlfriend, Colony? Pleasure asked, snapping me out of my thoughts. My shit complicated. Even if I had a girlfriend, ain't no law that says I can't look. P, I'm 17 years old with a pair of eyes on me that like to wander. I'ma go ask her for her number. Look at the one with the purple and yellow striped shirt. She fine, ain't it? I asked. Pleasure just giggled while shaking her head. What do you do when you want a girl? I'm curious to hear this. She crossed her arms and stared at me, giving me her undivided attention as she waited for my answer. P, to keep it real with you, I never really got to approach a girl. They be writing me on Instagram. They'll walk up to me in public or they'll send their homegirls over telling me that they got somebody who wants to talk to me. Nani is probably the only girl that I've ever been serious about, even though our shit is complicated, but I've been knowing Nani since I was a little nigga, so it was easy to snag her. To answer your question, though, if I want a female, I like her picture on social media or I'll walk up to her on some cool shit and just ask for her number, I told her. So, in other words, your ass don't got no game. She tried to play me, and that shit made me laugh. Man, call me Kobe because I got all the game. How my pop snag you? Now, that nigga looks like he don't got no game. He's always so damn busy that he looks like he had his assistant confront you for him, I told her. She laughed and rolled her eyes at me. Leave my husband alone. My man does have game. Corporate didn't approach me, though. I've always been the kind of woman to go after anything I want, so I approached your father. I came at him crazy and got my ass cursed out. But you know your daddy is missing a few screws, so me coming at him sideways really just had him wanting me more. Still to this day, I don't know how he got my number, but he got it. And he played the cat and mouse game with me for a while before he finally asked me out on a date. Our first date was special. He rented out the whole restaurant for me. Your father paid attention to the little things, and that's what had me in love with him. At your young age, I don't expect you to be renting out restaurants and shit, but you can pay attention to the little things and win a girl over, she told me. I guess my pops could get a couple of brownie points because that renting out the restaurant shit was pretty smooth and on some next level boss shit. I be paying attention to the little things. When Nani is stressed out with school and shit or when her period be coming on, I get all her favorite candy and shit for her. I rub her stomach. I do all that shit. I gave her a stack last year for her birthday. I be stalking her social media, so when she posts a bag or something that she wants, I'll surprise her with it. I'm smooth with that shit. Trust me, I got game, I told her. And she gave me a serious look. You sound like you really love Nani, but at the same time, I don't expect you to be faithful at your young ass age. Didn't that girl just have an abortion? She questioned, and I nodded, letting her know she did. Then don't worry about the bitch that's across the room. Worry about your situation that you have back home, Pleasure advised. I hear you. What you think my pops will say if I ask him if Nani can come spend a week with us for spring break? It's coming up in a few weeks. Either that or I get a hotel room for the week for us, I said, and Pleasure laughed. You ask him and then let me know what he says. I can't speak for Corporate, so I don't know what he'll say, she advised. The waitress came over to take our orders. I ordered some mozzarella sticks for an appetizer, and for my meal, I got a big-ass cheeseburger with double fries. Pleasure ordered a chicken sandwich with fries, and when the waitress left, she talked my head off some more. While we were talking, my phone started vibrating on the table. It was a FaceTime call coming through from Xavier. I'd been ignoring the fuck out of her, and I was sure she just wanted to hear my voice, so I went ahead and answered for her. Her beautiful chocolate face popped up on the screen, and from her surroundings, I could tell she was at work. Xavier worked as a project manager for a big real estate company out in Atlanta. She brought in good money, and about 5 years ago, she became a homeowner, purchasing a nice-ass crib for just the two of us. It was never money that had Xavier pulling up on my pops and leaving me with him, because she'd always been able to take care of the two of us, even back then when she didn't always have it. It was the fact that she simply couldn't deal with handling me on her own anymore that had her leaving me in Miami. How are you, son? I've been calling you. What's going on? She asked as she glared at me. I could see the light blue dress shirt she was wearing, and because my mama's hair always stayed on point, she was rocking some curly weave that was parted down the middle and hanging loosely. She looked at me like she was genuinely concerned that I hadn't been answering the phone for her. I'm good. I just got out of school not too long ago. I'm having dinner, I told her, and she nodded. Okay, are you with your dad? She asked. No, I'm with Pleasure, I said. Oh, okay. Colony, how are you? I send you text messages and stuff throughout the day, just wanting to talk to you, but you're not responding. It's been 3 months since you've been in Miami with your father. Are you adjusting? Have you met any friends? She wanted to know. I laughed at her last question while just shaking my head. Ma, chill out. You acting like this my first day of kindergarten or some shit. I'm 17 years old and a junior in high school. I don't need no friends. All my friends are back home in Atlanta. I'm good, though. I just been chilling, going to school and coming home. Why you still at work? I thought you'd be out of the office by 4, I said, as the waitress came over and set my mozzarella sticks in front of me. It's been busy at the office, but I'm going to be out of here within the next hour. Ashanti's birthday is coming up next month, and she's putting together a girl's trip to Miami, so I'm going to be that way. I plan to get in town a couple of days before her trip because I wanted to spend some time with you. That's cool? She asked. Ashanti was my mom's best friend. The two of them were road dogs and were always up to no good together. Ashanti was cool. I looked at her as an aunt because she'd been in the picture since I was about 5 years old, so she was family to me. Aye, that's cool, I told her. Call me tonight before you go to sleep. I love you, Colony, she said. Love you too. With that, I hung the phone up. I finished my conversation with pleasure after talking with Xavier. The food came, and once we finished eating, I still tried to be slick and pay for our meal, but pleasure wouldn't let me. Assuring me again that my money wasn't any good when I was with her, she footed the bill, but the nigga in me wanted to do something, so I left the tip. Before leaving, I took one last look at the girl at that table, mainly staring at the one who had caught my attention. I heard the shit in my head that pleasure told me about how I needed to treat Nani better, so I ain't even go over there and ask her for her number. Spring break was coming up soon, and I really wanted Nani to come down and spend some time with me. I only told pleasure that our shit was complicated because that's how it felt these days. Back in Atlanta, no matter how busy I was, I always pulled up on my girl to see her. With us living miles apart now, the relationship just didn't feel the same, but we loved each other, so we were trying to make our shit work. You 17. Spell love, my guy. I'm gonna need you to do that. I couldn't be out here entertaining no outside bitches because I already knew that would be the first question Nani asked when she touched down. When that question came, I wanted to be able to tell her the truth versus looking her in her eyes and lying to her like I used to do back in Atlanta. I wanted to show that I'd grown a bit during my time away from her. And that's the end of that chapter. Okay, so pleasure is going to help him be a better young man. So yeah, we happy about that. Hey, Lexi, happy Friday and welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. I thought I saw somebody else come in, child. Okay, so Lil Mama came back. All right, that's what I'm talking about. And now you got to put a picture in there, child, like you had before. Hey, Andy, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. And you too, Naja. Welcome, welcome. Hey, Chocolate Z, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. Buck, who likes to fuck? Welcome, darling. Thank you. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Y'all the fucking backyardigans. I'm over it. Y'all know I put that shit from the backyardigans up there for y'all because y'all always talking about being in the backyard. All right, let me get this timestamp for chapter 2, child. Okay. That was a long-ass chapter, too, y'all. That thing was 20 minutes, 24 minutes long, to be exact, while you playing. Very long chapter. Hey, Kaylin. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Melanin, welcome, darling. Thank you. Aw, thank you for the compliment. She said, you are a great narrator and hilarious. Child, listen, I'm just up here talking shit. I'm just saying what I really be feeling. Y'all. Oh, I was sipping my coffee, child. Now I got a big-ass cauldron of coffee. Don't be mad. All right, here we go. Chapter 2. Corporate strong. I got Kaylin and Jaleesa. Hey, y'all. Hey, welcome. Thank y'all for being here. 2 a.m, and I was downstairs in my office with stress balls in my hand, staring at the wall with all kinds of shit on my mind. I needed to be upstairs in bed sleeping because Pleasure had her first prenatal appointment at 9 a.m. With the Miami traffic, we'd have to leave about an hour before the appointment time since they wanted us there at least 20 minutes before the appointment to fill out paperwork. This had been me every night, though. Granted, I'd never been the type to have sleep come easily to me, but since the constant bullshit started in my life, it's really been hard to get some peaceful sleep. Out of all the shit on my mind, the thing that kept me up right now was Kyle. I was so fucking angry with myself that if I could beat my own ass for keeping that nigga alive when I had him right in front of me, that had to be the dumbest shit I'd ever done. I knew I was an asshole, and I knew he was the person that not many got along with, but I never in my life expected this man to be stealing from me. This man really took fucking bricks that belonged to the business and gave that shit to the very same niggas that I let walk months ago. That gotta be the grimiest shit that a nigga has ever done to me. What made this situation so bad was the fact that this nigga was family. This was my blood uncle, my pop's younger brother, and this was the bullshit he pulled. At the same time, how shocked could I be? Because this was the same nigga who fucked his brother's wife. The fact that he's a thief really shouldn't come as any surprise to me. No matter how heartbroken or vulnerable my mama was the night that she came to Kyle, that nigga was supposed to never stop that fucking, or sorry, stoop that fucking low and fuck her. Even if Sade came on to him on some get back shit to try and hurt Kato, that nigga was supposed to never stick his fucking dick in her. That was the lowest shit he could have ever done. When Nene was with Chaotic and she would come to me crying and telling me the bullshit my brother had done to her, I never had any thoughts of fucking my brother's girl. Nene was like my little fucking sister. I loved that girl. And having any kind of sexual relations with her had never crossed my mind. That just goes to show you how real of a nigga I was and how Kyle was fucking dirty. I couldn't wait to find his ass so I could beat the fuck out of him for hours, put that nigga through all kinds of pain and suffering, and then off his ass. You would be a fool to think I hadn't been riding past his house or Kyrie's house looking for them niggas. I'd been popping up at odd times, too. In fact, I just walked in the door about an hour ago because I was stationed out in the apartment complex where Kyle resided, waiting for that nigga to bring his ass home. But everything inside me screamed that he wasn't coming home. I hated the fact that he knew the kind of calculated nigga I was, and he knew that his house or Kyrie's house would be the first two places that I looked for him. Okay, excuse me. Neither of them was stupid enough to bring their asses home. And truth be told, I ain't have a clue where they were. Not only was that on my mind, but I was also thinking about the fact that my wife had to catch yet another body. Pleasure killing that nigga in the restroom at Mercy's new club was justified, but the part that had me up at night unable to sleep was how Pleasure was able to beat death by how quick she'd been able to get to her gun and off that nigga. Suppose I hadn't beat that shit into her fucking head about how important it was for her to have her gun on her at all times. Suppose I hadn't taught Pleasure how to shoot all those years ago. I really could have been a fucking widower right now after losing my wife and my unborn, and that shit fucked me up. After that shit went down, you know Pleasure and I came home and pillow talked about that shit. Before she killed that nigga, he spoke my son's name. Niggas who I was beefing with knew I had a son, which I wasn't surprised about because when I was out, I had Colony with me. But the fact that they'd done their research and found out his name, that shit had reminded me why I never wanted any kids in the first place. Wow. This is crazy. I always said that if a nigga wanted to hurt me in this business, they would go after my kids, and I'd been right this whole time. I could just feel it in my spirit that I was about to have to kill motherfuckers like I'd never done before. I'd have to drop down on my knees and repent for the shit I was getting ready to do out here in these streets. As I continued to ponder the situation, there were a couple of knocks on the office door, and whoever was on the other side didn't even wait for me to tell them to come inside. Instead, I heard the doorknob turn, and then the door was pushed open. Pleasure walked in, but honestly, I expected it to be Colony. Those were his hours to be up late on that damn game, talking shit with whoever he would be playing against. Pleasure was the last person I expected to see because she'd knocked out in our bed by a little after 11. She'd been on the phone with her girls, talking shit with them for the majority of the night, and then she joined me in bed. Did all that fucking talking on the phone to the point that she tired herself out, and I didn't even get any pussy. She'd knocked out in the bed, sitting up with her back pressed against the headboard and her head resting on my shoulder, falling asleep in the middle of the movie that I'd put on for us. Now, there she was, coming downstairs in her black silk two-piece pajamas with sleepiness in her eyes. She probably was confused about why my ass was down there. Shit, when she knocked out, I got dressed and took my ass to Kyle's house, where I'd camped out, waiting to see if he would bring his ass home. I'd been down there ever since. Why you down here, Corporate? I've been looking all over this damn house for you. Almost fell down the damn stairs, she said, sounding aggravated with me for almost falling down the stairs like I was the cause of that shit. If I had learned anything while married, it was that no matter what happened, it would always somehow be my damn fault for whatever the fuck went wrong. Boom. Take notes, fellas. That's marriage. Everything that happens is your goddamn fault. All right. Now, I was nowhere near them damn stairs, yet she had an attitude with a nigga like I'd pushed her or some shit. How you almost fell down the stairs? Because you had the hall light off. Come upstairs. Why you got out of bed anyway? Where did you go? She asked, firing off question after question as she walked further inside the office after closing the door behind her and locking it. I wasn't used to my wife walking around the house with this much clothes on. Pleasure acted like she was allergic to clothes and she barely had any on when she was in this motherfucker. So to see her in some long silk pajamas with a silk spaghetti strap pajama top had me wanting to touch her head and see if she was okay. I was used to her going to sleep naked or with just her underwear on, and she would often walk around the house like that too. But since Colony was living with us now and Big Ma, she was wearing more clothes, and I had a love-hate relationship with that shit. I mean, I understood why she had to do it, but damn, I missed coming home to her in the kitchen cooking dinner for me naked. Can't sleep. I can't do nothing. Just went riding, I assured her as she walked over and straddled my lap. Her arms went around my neck as she stared down at me and mine were on her ass, just keeping my hands there as I looked at her, knowing she would speak her mind and tell me how she felt. Pleasure sighed, and that sigh held a lot of meaning, a sigh that let me know she had a lot of shit on her mind just as I did. What? I asked. Corporate, I feel like you're not mentally here with me. That's all. Physically, you're right in my face, but mentally, I feel like you're somewhere totally ducked off from being with me. I'm pregnant. I can feel myself being very emotional, but I've been fighting like hell to control my emotions when I'm around you because I know you have a lot on your plate right now, and I don't want it to seem like I'm nagging. I want my feet rubbed from time to time. I want you to raise my shirt and rub my belly. I want you to be able to leave work early so you can take me on a date. Corporate, I don't even know the last time you and I went on a date. You're here with me physically, but I don't know where the hell your mind is, my wife told me. Baby, we just went to dinner a couple of days ago, I reminded her. She rolled her eyes at that as she looked at me with a serious expression. Yeah, but Colony and Chaotic were both there. When's the last time you took me on a date? She asked. I don't know. I'll take you on one Friday, I told her. She just shook her head and attempted to get up, but I held onto her ass even tighter, not wanting her to go. Don't worry about it, Corporate. I don't want to be taken on a date because I said something. It's cool, she said, and attempted to stand up again, but this time I just sucked my teeth and let her go. P, what the fuck you want from a nigga, yo? You said you want to go on a fucking date and for me to get off earlier from work, and I was going to fucking do that on Friday. I was going to take Colony to Sade's house so I can take you out. I understand that as your husband, I'm slacking in a lot of shit, but you act like a nigga's intentionally doing that shit. All this fucking bullshit that I'm in the middle of. So excuse me if I ain't taking you out to get a fucking filet mignon and the finest fucking wine on the menu as I handle this shit before our fucking child gets here. Damn, man, I snapped. Pleasure stood in front of me, looking like she wanted to slap the shit out of me, but she knew not to do it. I just had a long fucking conversation with her ass not too long ago about putting her hands on me. Sleep down here. Don't even come upstairs, she snapped before turning on her heels and walking to the door. That shit made a nigga laugh. P, go find you something safe to play with, aye? I look like the kind of nigga that's gonna sleep on a couch or an opposite bedroom from my wife. Maybe you should switch up whatever prenatal pills you taking for a different brand because that shit is fucking with your brain cells. Oh my God, y'all. Oh my God, y'all. Oh Lord, have mercy. I stated as I stood up from the chair to follow her. Something told me that her ass was going to try to be slick when she got upstairs and locked the bedroom door. Then I'd have to wake the whole house up from kicking the fucking door in. I wasn't trying to have those kind of problems, so I was just going to get to the bedroom. Okay, I see you. Thank you. Listen, y'all, they trying to do better and make noise and shit so they don't scare the shit out of bitch when they come downstairs. All right. I wasn't trying to have those kind of problems, so I was just going to get to the bedroom at the same time as pleasure, so shit wouldn't have to go that far. Whatever, Corporate. I'll sleep in a different room then. You're really starting to get on my fucking nerves, she spat as we walked up the stairs. And you think you don't get on mine? You bipolar as a motherfucker, P. My dick has been buried in you every day this week, and now, all of a sudden, I get on your fucking nerves. Shit crazy. All this because you think a nigga not gonna take you on a date. I understand that I've been slacking, but damn, give a nigga some time to get it right, I said from behind her. We eventually made it to the top of the stairs, and she started walking fast as hell down the long hallway that led to our bedroom. Once she got to the door, she walked in and attempted to close and lock that shit, just like I knew she would. However, I was able to catch the door with my hand, and I walked in behind her and closed it, then locked it myself. I heard her release a sigh before she kicked her house shoes off, left them by the foot of the bed, and climbed in. Womp, womp. Thanks for playing. All right. She got on her side and lay down with her back facing me. This was just normal marriage shit that we were doing right now. Nothing to see here. My wife was in her feelings, as she was a few times a week, and I stood there questioning God about why the hell he had to make women so fucking crazy. I won't act like I didn't understand where my wife was coming from, but at the same time, she knew this wasn't a situation where I was purposely neglecting her and choosing not to do nice shit. I was wearing so many hats, trying to be in so many places at one time and guarding so many people from getting hurt, so I haven't been able to give pleasure the shit she wanted, but I was gonna get better with that shit. I removed my house shoes as well and came out of my wife beater, leaving me wearing just my pajama bottoms. The TV was on in the room, but it was turned down really low. I picked up the remote, turned the TV off, and I set the remote back on the nightstand. Then I went over to pleasure side of the bed and got behind her. You know her petty ass tried to push a nigga back, but I was on her ass, not about to let her go anywhere. No lie, my ass was tired, which was some shit you would rarely hear me say. I'd been pulling all-nighters, having my mind just wander, unable to get any sleep. So, at that moment, I was paying for that shit as I spooned pleasure. My right hand went under her silk pajama top, and I rubbed her flat stomach. My head was buried into the crook of her neck as I breathed in her scent, loving how good she smelled. Baby, give a nigga time to get it right. Don't put a nigga in the group chat and sell me the fuck out. This is hilarious, I told her. She released a low laugh that I knew she was fighting like hell to keep to herself. I knew all about that flaw-ass group chat that she was in with her girls. I don't go through my wife's phone or no shit like that because that was bitch shit. But pleasure often told me some of the shit that she and her girls be talking about, and I would sit there pretending to be engaged, knowing damn well I couldn't give two fucks about all that gossip she be letting me in on. Also knew they talked a bunch of shit in those chats, and nobody was off limits. Years back when Chaotic was with Nene and they were going through their shit, his dumb ass went through Nene's phone. He went through the text messages from their chat, and my brother was actually the one to tell me how they be talking big shit in there. I can't wait to talk shit about you in the morning, she responded and released a yawn because she was tired but steadily trying to pick a fight with a nigga. I snaked my hand up, going for her right breast, and with my eyes closed, I started twiddling her nipples. Pleasure's breasts were so fucking soft. I felt like they'd grown a bit since the pregnancy, too. Before, they would fit into my large hand so perfectly, only spilling out a little. Now, those shits were so hefty, spilling out more than a little bit, but because I was such a titty man, I loved that shit. Tired as a motherfucker, but with my eyes closed, I was still playing with her nipples, and now I had my lips on her neck where I sucked. My big man was in my pants, jumping on Pleasure's ass, waiting to be freed so he could slip into some slippery shit. Crazy the lengths a nigga go to just to get some pussy. I could barely keep my eyes open, and I was still trying to get my dick wet. Crazy. P, pull him out for me, I whispered in her ear, damn near groaning because I wasn't even inside yet, but I was already anticipating how good that shit would feel the moment I pushed in. Thank God my wife was a team player and she ain't hold that little petty-ass disagreement that we just had over my head. Right, she put it on a nightstand. She'll pick it up when y'all get through. She removed her pajama bottoms and panties and tossed them to the floor. Then she slipped her hand inside my briefs, pulled her dick out, and started rubbing the head up and down the back of her pussy, which was already leaking. Finally, she pushed my dick in, and with my eyes still closed, I finished off the work, burying my dick until I was damn near balls deep. I pulled her shirt over her head and tossed it to the floor. Then my hands went around her neck, adding pressure. While she fucked back, I long stroked her, biting my lip, unable to fully grasp how, after all these years of fucking her pussy, still had a nigga in a chokehold. You be arguing with a nigga only to be standing there with a dripping pussy. That shit don't sound toxic to you, I asked, tightening the grip I had on her neck as I continued to stroke. I hit against a spot that would have her coming in a few seconds. She'd bury her sharp-ass nails into my thighs and try to push a nigga out while I repeatedly hit up against it, trying to get it a squirt. Corporate, she screeched my name. Why you moaning my name like that? I thought I got on your fucking nerves, I asked, fucking with her. You do. Your dick don't, though. Stay right there and come with me. Shit, she moaned, releasing her juices onto my dick. Just like I predicted, her hands reached back and she buried her nails in my thighs, trying to run from that pressure I was giving her. I removed my hands from her throat and placed them on her flat stomach. Then I drilled into her pussy, getting her to squirt. I got my nut off too, dumping it all inside her. I ain't even pull out after. Instead, I left the dick in, letting her feel it throb inside of her as I kept her wrapped in my arms while I breathed into the crook of her neck. That pussy was gonna have a nigga pass the fuck out one day. You done got me started, Corporate. Come on, Pleasure said, and attempted to get up, but I kept my arm on her stomach, not wanting her to move. My dick could have kept going, but it was my body that was trying to give out on me. A nigga was dead fucking tired, but the pussy was right here, and I could feel that energy coming from my wife. She was trying to get nasty with a nigga, so it was a battle between staying my ass up or going to sleep. Pleasure was able to get out of the hold I had her in, and I turned over on my back, putting my hands behind my head and lusting over my fine-ass wife. She removed my pajama bottoms and briefs, tossing them on the floor. You don't feel like you toxic? I had to ask her again. He is such a fucking asshole. Sir, do you want some ass or no? How you gonna ask a bitch if she toxic and expect her to still want to fuck? Oh my God. She rolled her eyes at my question as she sat that ass on my chest. I just licked my lips because I already knew what she was getting ready to do. She was about to disrespectfully put that pussy right on my nose because I argue with my husband and then let you fuck me. That's not toxic, Corporate. It's called real life. Our shit's not going to be peachy 24/7. Negro, you don't think you're toxic? If I had locked the door on you and you kicked it in and we started arguing and you would have still fucked me after all of that, your ass is toxic, she snapped. Pleasure reached back so her hands could go on my thighs and she scooted all the way up. That pussy went right on my nose, just like I knew she would do. On some chill shit, I kept my hands behind my head, not holding her or anything, and I ate straight up the pussy, tongue kissing her clit, sucking and kissing all over it, tongue fucking her, having Pleasure go crazy. When she came, she snapped her legs closed, unable to take it anymore, and then she got back in my lap and started riding me. I wasn't even tired anymore because this shit had woke a nigga up for real. When she finished riding, I put her on all fours. I put on my best performance, trying to knock the pussy out the frame. Then I gave her some dick against the wall. The type of wild fucking we just did had her sweating, so I had to carry my wife to the bathroom where we took a quick shower together before we got back in bed. I wonder if I'd be shaking the baby when I'm fucking you all crazy like that. I'ma chill out with all of that, I blurted out as Pleasure had her head resting on my chest. She lifted her head, laughed at what I said, and then tugged on my beard. I could look at her beautiful face all day, even when she worked my fucking nerves. Corporate, please, I'm excited about our appointment in the morning. It's like I want a son because I can see myself being a boy mom and having my little man all fly, but at the same time, I would want a mini me. I want a beautiful chocolate baby, my wife expressed. That shit made a nigga smile. In all the years that I'd been with Pleasure, she'd never openly talked to me about wanting kids. She always ran away from questions like that and never let the thought of having children even enter her mind. You know how most women go through a phase of having baby fever or some shit like that? Pleasure had never done that. At most, if we were in public and she saw a cute baby, she would smile and gush for me to look at the baby, but that was it. I couldn't wait to see my wife in mommy mode. I'd already gotten somewhat of a peek at it by seeing the kind of amazing stepmother she was to Colony, but seeing my wife with a newborn baby and how in love I knew her ass would be with our child was something I couldn't wait to witness. I swear I don't want another you. P, I don't even smoke, but I may start hitting the blunt with my brothers, I told her, and she laughed. What's wrong with me? Why wouldn't you want a little pleasure running around? She asked as she cocked her head to the side. P, you always get your fucking way. We've been in this shit together for almost 12 years, and in that time, I can probably count on two hands the number of times that I've told you no. You know what look to give me to get your way. Can you imagine a baby version of you? P, that little girl will have me fucked up. Nah, I ain't even in the business to be playing with them kinds of games. If I ever gotta tell my daughter no, I'm gonna put you in charge of being the bad guy, I shared. She was cracking up with laughter listening to the shit I said to her. That's bullshit, Corporate. You'll tell our son no in a heartbeat, huh? She questioned. Shit, it'd be hard to tell him no, too. I don't want my sons hustling. I don't even want that shit for Colony, but with him, I feel like it may be a little too late. The nigga got that hustle all up in him. I be trying to talk to him about college and shit, but he ain't trying to hear none of that. He's smart as hell, so I already know he'll do good at a university, but I can't push my wants on him. At the same time, this lifestyle that I live, I don't want it for my boys. I'm probably the only nigga in the Strong family who thinks like this. The rest of them be ready to get their sons the key to the streets. So what are you going to do, though, when it comes to Colony then? Just like you said, that boy has hustle in him. And Corporate, it's in his eyes, his mannerisms, everything. When I'm around him, I just can't believe how much of a person can remind me so much of you. I feel like because that hunger is in him and he's going to hustle, whether you like it or not, you may just have to show him the game. It would be better for him to learn it from you than go somewhere else and get his ass killed. If I could have it my way, though, I would want him to take his ass to college and go a whole other route. But like you said, we can't push our wants on him. My wife told me some real shit, and I couldn't help but nod my head and agree with her. My eyes were getting low, so instead of engaging anymore in that conversation, I just pulled the covers up so it covered both our bodies. She still had her head resting on my chest while I had my right arm extended, resting on her ass. My other hand was behind my head while I lay on my back. With my eyes closed, I licked my lips. The next time you want some dick from a nigga, you don't gotta go picking fights. Just say what you want. Be grown about your shit. I had to get that shit off my chest before I called it a night. Pleasure giggled, and I already knew that some slick shit was gonna come behind that giggle. Corporate, this me. You know I don't have to start a fight to get some dick out of you. I'll pull that dick out in a second and get to riding. Act like you don't know who you married to, she preached. I did a lazy laugh after she said that shit, and then I took my ass to sleep. A nigga had a long-ass day, and sleeping seemed to be the only time I could get my mind to ease the fuck up and not have me thinking about all the bullshit that I'd been up against. And that's the end of that chapter. Since we done got this far, y'all know it's about to be some shit, right? Like, for real, it's about to be some shit, I'm sure, in this next chapter. Did I speak to you, Jazzy Child? I don't even know where the fuck I'm at, honey. I have no idea. But let me just go up here. Okay. Hey, Sweet November and Danielle. Welcome, y'all. Thank you for being here. I appreciate y'all. All right, who else came in? Okay, Jazzy, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. I think I got everybody because I spoke to Miss Pretty. Yep. I think I got everybody. Chocolate Z, I got her. Yep. Okay, I think I got everybody. Already spoke to Buns. Is there anybody that I missed? If I missed you, say something again, okay? Because I don't know what the fuck is going on, okay? How about that? All right. So let me get this next time stamp, honey, so we can boogie on down the road, because y'all know I'm here for a good time and what? Not a long time. But y'all gonna have to give me a minute to wet my whistle, because I'm a whole human being up here. Anybody seen Peanut today? Where she at? She must be busy working, getting that bread. But normally she try to pop in over here on Friday, but we'll see. Church lady said, I see y'all, but I ain't coming out there. Y'all got me fucked up. She said she not coming outside. She said that coffee cauldron sounds like whole book energy. Shit, no it don't. No ma'am. No God. All right. Chapter 3, Pleasure Strong. No, look again. Something has definitely got to be wrong. There's no way, I uttered in disbelief as I looked over at my doctor, who was smiling as she stared at the screen while she had the probe on my belly moving it around. This woman had just let the word twins fly out of her mouth. I wasn't even the type of person to sweat, but when she said it a minute ago, I instantly started sweating profusely, and I felt like I was getting ready to pass the hell out. There was no way in the world that I was pregnant with twins right now. No way. Look, I prayed long and hard about deciding to accept this pregnancy and to rid myself of all the fears and doubts that I had about becoming a mother, only to be set right back as the possibility of me having twins was now a reality. My husband was standing right next to me, holding my hand, looking as if he was getting ready to pass out his damn self. Corporate was the kind of man who always had something to say. He literally always had a solution for every problem, and he gave good advice. But at that moment, he stood there with his jaw damn near on the floor as he looked at the doctor like even he was taken aback by what she just told us. Trust me, I'm looking again, Mrs. Strong, and I can see perfectly that there are two babies growing inside of you. Look right here at baby A. You're still early on, so it's kind of hard to make out what it is through the ultrasound, but that's definitely the first baby. And right here, off to the side, is baby B. Congratulations, mommy. You are definitely a soon-to-be mommy of twins. Pleasure. Consider it a blessing. Oh, the things I would do to be a mommy of twins. Also, look at it like this. You're killing two birds with one stone, knocking out having two babies at one time, my doctor said in a joking manner. I didn't respond. I just stared off into the distance. No lie, I kind of zoned out after that. It was just a lot to take in. I didn't know why I was in my head so much about becoming a mother. I felt like the pressure was now doubled for me to be a great mother, since now I would be the mother of two kids. Rhodesia had scarred my ass to the point that I honestly had fears of fucking up to the extent that she'd done with me, and I didn't want my children to grow up hating me the way I hated her. Granted, I knew I wouldn't be shit like the mother she was to me, to my children, but I still had so many fears that I couldn't seem to shake. Damn, Doc, I think the biggest thing I was worried about today was finding out how far along Pleasure is. Like she told you when you walked in, she had been drinking because she didn't know she was pregnant, but I didn't expect you to tell us that she was pregnant with twins. Damn, can you tell if it's girls or boys inside? Corporate asked, sounding genuinely concerned, and the doctor laughed. It was confirmed at my appointment that I was a little over 12 weeks pregnant, which made the most sense because that was around the time I really started stressing and I had gotten sloppy with taking my pills. I was forgetting to take them in the mornings, skipping days and whatnot. That explained the tiredness that started a couple of months back, along with my mood swings. It was crazy because Koi had honestly called this pregnancy out months ago, and at the time I swore on everything that her ass didn't have a clue what she was talking about when she had been right this whole time. I'm not gonna lie, knowing the way I was drinking on the cruise and finding out that I had been pregnant that entire time felt like it was already setting the tone for the kind of mother I would be. I'd been quiet pretty much since it was confirmed how far along I was. Not yet. It's still too early to tell. Listen, I can tell that you two are severely shocked by this news, since you expected to come here and find out that Mrs. Strong is carrying one baby. What I can tell you from past patients that I've had with twins is that it will definitely be a lot of work. Having a kid in general is a lot of work. And with you having two, the work is now double, but nothing is impossible. As long as you have support, you two will be just fine. Enjoy those beautiful first few moments with your little ones because it goes fast. My oldest just started middle school this year and I'm having trouble wrapping my mind around the fact that it feels like I just brought her home from the hospital. Pleasure. I can see that your mood kind of shifted once you realized how far along you were and you revealed to me that you'd been drinking. You are fine. You are at a stage in your pregnancy where everything is where it's supposed to be. You're nice and healthy, so embrace that and don't beat yourself up because you were drinking. You didn't know. Just don't drink anything else while you're pregnant, she told me, and I giggled at that while I nodded my head. I felt like she'd been able to tap into my head and call me out on what really had me shutting down. From there, she finished doing the ultrasound, and before she left the room, she printed out images and handed them to Corporate and me. Now, it was just my husband and me in the room by ourselves while I held the ultrasound pictures in my hand. I hadn't even realized I was crying until I saw one of my tears hit the paper. Those weren't sad tears. My ass was just scared and overwhelmed that there were two babies growing inside me. All the fucking we do. You think that's the reason you're carrying twins? Corporate asked. I laughed through my tears as I playfully pushed him. He came and stood between my legs, placing both his hands on my stomach, which was still flat. I knew within the next couple of weeks I'd be working with a little pudge. While his hands were on my stomach, I reached my right hand up and placed it in his hair, smoothing his waves and looking at him like he was the one with all the answers. A lot of times when I'm scared or I'm just not as confident as I should be, it was my husband who I leaned on to help me get through whatever problem I had. Corporate just always seemed to have all the right things to say. I go from having no kids to one, and in a few months, I'm going to be a father of three. Life is so fucking crazy. P, listen, I know we were only expecting one baby, but hey, God saw favor in us to give us two, and we're going to embrace that. I know it's going to be double the work, just like the doctor said, but P, you know I'll never put your ass in no situation where you got to take care of two newborns by yourself. Hell, you ain't got to take care of them by yourself when they become toddlers, teenagers, none of that shit. I'm going to always be there. Our support system is so strong. You done told your girls already that you're pregnant and they already fucking fighting over being babysitters. Sade already made it clear how this is her damn baby. P, we gonna be good. For the rest of this pregnancy, your ass don't gotta do shit. Sit back and just enjoy being put up. You can eat all the unhealthiest shit in the world and I swear I won't preach to you about none of that shit, he told me. Through tears that were falling down my face, I laughed while rolling my eyes at him. Thank you, baby, I replied before leaning my head up and kissing him on his lips. I'm so ready for you to fill out with this pregnancy. I only ever saw you at this weight, so I can't wait to see you toting that big-ass stomach and waddling around the house. Your stomach gonna be extra big since you carrying twins. I could honestly hear the excitement in his voice, and it was rubbing off on me. So I sat there and cheesed at my husband as I listened to him speak. What if it's two boys? Corporate, I'm gonna cry like a big ass baby because I'm gonna be so happy. You know how much I wanna be a boy, Mom. My voice cracked as I spoke about my future sons. I was heavily emotional and at a point in my pregnancy where I'd learned to embrace the fact that I was carrying. I woke up in the morning and prayed over my baby. When I was in bed, lying down, I would talk to my baby. And at night, I made sure I got another prayer in as well. To know that there were two babies inside me and I already felt like I had a strong connection with them was amazing. Just knowing that I would be holding them in my arms in about 6 more months had my emotions all over the place. I couldn't believe that someone like my tough ass, who liked to hide my pain and never wanted to cry, had become so emotional like this. This pregnancy was bringing out the soft bitch in me. I feel like I'm trying to replace them fucking boys with me. I can see that shit now, P. Corporate joked as he casually wiped the tears from my face. He'd gotten so used to my emotions being all over the place these days that he would allow me to get it out without any judgment on his end, and I love that. After laughing at what he said, I kissed him one more time on his lips, and then he helped me get down from the chair that I'd been sitting in all this time. I grabbed my jeans and put them back on, then I slipped my sandals back on my feet. Once I grabbed my purse, Corporate held the door open for me, and I walked out first. Before leaving, we went up to the front to schedule my next appointment, which would be in 4 weeks. We made it to the car, and just 5 minutes after we got inside, his phone started ringing. It was Chaotic calling. Corporate had his phone hooked up to Bluetooth in the car, so I saw when Chaotic's name flashed on the screen. Corporate went ahead and answered. What's good? Corporate greeted. Chilling? Y'all still at P's appointment? He asked. We just got in the car. Corporate let him know. Cool. What they saying? That's gonna be one mean-ass fucking baby. You ain't ever gotta worry about a nigga babysitting. Chaotic talked shit, and I laughed. I wasn't gonna leave my baby with you anyway, nigga. I shot. I could hear him laughing. I'm fucking with you. You good, though? How your appointment went? Chaotic wanted to know. It was good. I'm pregnant with twins, I revealed. Oh, hell no. As in, you got two fucking babies in your stomach? He asked, giving me the reaction that I'd wanted to give the doctor after she dropped that bomb on me. Yep, it's two babies, Chaotic, I assured him. Hell no. If Nene had told a nigga some shit like that, we would have had to send one of them damn babies back. Now I'm just fucking around with y'all, though. Congrats. Y'all gonna be amazing parents, Chaotic let us know, and I thanked him. What's good, Kay? You ain't just called me to see what happened at P's appointment, Corporate said. Oh no. You know I got my ears to the streets, and word is that Amiri is looking for his brother. It's been 2 weeks since that shit happened at the club, and that nigga wants to know where his brother at. Ain't nobody really saying nothing, and from what I'm putting together, not too many people really knew his brother went to the strip club that night. that nigga had to slip in through a back door or something, because I was with Mercy the other day and he was trying to pull up the footage from when the nigga came through the front and he couldn't find it. Mercy said it's one door in the back and the cameras weren't set up there yet. He said the cooks used that door to go in and out, putting out trash and shit. So he said Aiden had to have gotten in through that door. However this shit goes, them niggas not going to be able to prove it, but they going to know that we somehow had something to do with the disappearance of that nigga, Chaotic stated. And they were going to be well within their fucking rights to think we had something to do with it. That nigga was about to rape my fucking wife and he was going to kill her. So fuck him. That nigga served all that time in prison just to come home and get his ass killed. Shit crazy, but thanks for the heads up on that. I'm about to go to the Enterprise, handle some business there, and I'm chilling for the rest of the day, Corporate responded. He and his brother talked for a little while longer, and then they hung up. Corporate was driving the car with his left hand. With his right hand, he squeezed my thigh. He was doing that thing where he couldn't control his reflexes, so every few seconds, his hand would unintentionally grab my thigh, which let me know his mind was running a mile a minute. I had to place my hand on top of his and caress it in an attempt to calm him down. I didn't say anything because I knew he was too much in his thoughts. My mind was racing as well, and I didn't want to interrupt whatever he was thinking about at that moment. We eventually pulled up to the Enterprise, and Corporate parked his car in front. There were all kinds of exotic cars lined up, and just as quickly as I saw them was as quickly as they would go, because this was Miami, where people love to flex in beautiful cars. They love to pull up to a nice restaurant, valet park their car in front, or just drive around this beautiful city in a nice whip. I haven't been to the Enterprise in a few weeks, so this was my first time seeing the new Trackhawks. There were about five of them, and I walked over to admire them. You looking at that car like you want one. You want it? My husband asked, coming over and standing on the side of the car. No, it's beautiful, though. I'm just now seeing it, I said. I'm gonna get you a mommy van. That's the type of shit you gonna need while you toting my twins around, he blurted. Corporate, please, don't buy me no damn van. Get me an Escalade, I said as I walked past him. He slapped me on my ass and followed me as I led the way. We made it to the front door of the building and he reached over my head to open it and I walked in first. We spoke to all his staff before I walked to the back. I was surprised to see that Sade was in her office. This was a company that Corporate mainly ran by himself, and I did a lot of the paperwork while I bitched and moaned because Corporate would have me there for hours. Why you here, Sade? I feel like a nigga be having to pull your teeth to get you to come down here and work, Corporate stated as we walked into her office where she had the door open. When we walked in, she looked away from her desktop to put her eyes on us and she smiled. I could tell that Sade just hadn't been herself lately. Sade and I were cool as hell. It didn't even feel like our relationship was a mother-in-law and daughter duo because I could relate to Sade in so many ways. She was so easy to get along with, so it just felt like she was one of my homegirls. Since we handled a lot of business together, I was with her pretty much every day. We would take our lunch together and have the best conversations. When her truth was exposed at Cato's party, I could tell it embarrassed her. Listen, I ain't saying Sade was right and I ain't saying she was wrong. Now, I wasn't going to judge her for shit she did. What I can say is that a nigga will fucking push you there and you will want to act out in anger. As a woman, I knew that was the only reason she fucked Kyle. I knew I had big balls, but if Corporate fucked around on me, I wouldn't have fucked his brothers, though. For one, I wouldn't have even been alive long enough to tell the story because there was no doubt in my mind that Corporate would have killed me. He would have killed me and whichever brother I fucked, and he probably would have killed my girls for knowing about it and not saying shit. I knew my limits with Corporate, and I knew that that was something he would never be able to mentally handle. When we first got together, he would often confide in me about how he hated that his brothers had seen me naked when I used to dance. So can you imagine me having fucked one of them? God, I got chills up my spine just from thinking about the shit. I know Cody rented a car and he's supposed to be returning it, so I wanted to catch him while he was here. I can't get him on the phone. I just want to talk to him. How was the doctor's appointment? Sade asked as she stood up from her office chair and walked around the desk. I could see the stress in her eyes as she looked at the both of us, waiting for one of us to answer. Corporate had a hard look on his face as he glared down at his mother. You told Cody the same shit you told me about you taking a DNA test? Corporate wanted to know. I did, but I'm not sure if he believes me. It was my fuck up, so I gotta be the one to make it right, she said. As she spoke, the sound of a loud roaring engine came from outside. I glanced out of the window and saw an orange McLaren Artura. The car was beautiful and it was fast as hell. It was one of the cars at the Enterprise that was always rented out. With Cody just pulling back up with it, I was sure that as soon as the guys washed it and it was placed back on the app as available, it would be rented out again. To rent that car, Corporate required a $2,000 deposit, and it went for about $1,500 a day. People would spend that money too, because like I said, this was Miami, the city where people like to flex and pull up in nice shit. From where I was standing, I watched Cody back the car in and step out. He walked inside the building, and that's when Sade walked out of the office to catch up with him. The second she was gone, I turned to look at my husband, basically signaling with my eyes that some bullshit was about to happen, and I was kind of telling him to go out and play middleman. Although Cody was the nonchalant brother who rarely got rowdy, everyone knew this had him hurting, so there was a strong chance that he just might unravel when Sade went over and tried to have a conversation with him. Man, a nigga just came here to handle some business. Now I gotta get in the middle of some bullshit. Corporate spat before he aggressively kissed me on my cheek, and then he walked out of the office. I didn't know if I should take a seat, go over to the door to eavesdrop, or just walk out of the office to see what was going on. Pause. Girl, we need you to take your ass over there and listen so you can tell us what's going on. Fuck you mean? Ugh. Before I could even make up my mind, Sade walked back into the office and Cody lingered behind her along with Corporate. I normally love to be a fly on the wall for some good drama, but honestly, this was something that I didn't want to witness. I tried to be slick and walk my ass out, but Corporate grabbed me, stopping me from leaving. Oh, he dirty. We stood by the door, and I was planted in front of him while he had a protective arm wrapped around me. I sighed, knowing the damn drama that I was about to witness. I took a DNA test years ago, Cody. You don't belong to Kyle. Man, that ain't the point, Sade, and I think that's the part you're missing. You should have never fucked that nigga in the first place. You said Pops was doing his thing, fucking around on you, and Ma, you know as good as I know that there's plenty of niggas in Miami that you could have fucked around with to get even. You chose to fuck that man's brother, yo. We be going at it with Kyle all the fucking time, and that nigga always doing that signature smirk. This whole time, he had one up on us because he could boast and say that he fucked our mama. Shit crazy. Look, I'm about to dip. I ain't come down here for all that. He attempted to walk out of the office, but Sade rushed him and grabbed his arm. I know you said that me having sex with Kyle isn't the point, but I want you to have peace of mind and know that you don't belong to him. How you gonna do that, Sade, huh? We beefing with that nigga. The nigga you fuck stole bricks from the company, and now his black ass is about to be on the run. You think you gonna be able to just shoot the nigga a text, have him pull up, and he gonna willingly let you swab his mouth? Man, watch out, Cody snapped. He aggressively snatched his arm away from Sade and stormed out of the office. I thought it was best that she just let him cool down because Cody was too angry, and that wasn't the best time to talk to him. It just felt so weird to see him upset because he and Chaotic were the asshole brothers who always had a joke. They were always talking shit and never really taking life too seriously. So to see Cody walking in there, not even smiling, that's how I knew this shit was real. Corporate let me go and walked out of the office after his brother, leaving me alone with Sade. She'd taken a seat in one of the chairs facing her desk, and I walked over and sat in the empty one. She wasn't crying or anything, but she did look sad. Sade loved her boys. They all might have gotten on her damn nerves, but she was the prime example of a mother whose sons were her world. She loved them in a way that I wish Rhodesia had loved me. Sade had fucked up, but I had faith that everything was going to be okay. He's gonna come around, Sade. He's just angry right now. If Corporate's mean ass can forgive you, then Cody can too. I'm not gonna lie. I thought Corporate was done fucking with you for good once that secret was revealed. The nigga was too mad, I joked, making light of the situation. She laughed while shaking her head, but I could tell it was a forced laugh because Sade was hurting. What happened at the doctor? She asked again, because when she asked it before, Corporate didn't answer the question. I laughed while shaking my head. Sade, girl, I'm pregnant with twins. Sorry, I revealed. Her mouth dropped like she couldn't believe it. Oh my God, are you serious? She questioned. I dug into my purse and handed her the ultrasound pictures. She stared at it for a few seconds and then looked back over at me with a smile on her face. What was your reaction? You didn't pass out, did you? Damn near. You know I was crying. Corporate thought the doctor didn't know what the hell she was talking about, so he kept telling her to look again. Sade, what the hell am I gonna do with two kids? She kissed her teeth while looking at me like I was crazy. Pleasure, please. You'll figure it out just like the rest of the women in the world. I think you're being too hard on yourself, and I told you that before. You'll be a great mommy, Pleasure. Those babies are going to change you completely, though. You and Corporate. Watch how soft y'all become, she said. At the same time, Corporate walked back in, but he was by himself. He came over and took a seat on the arm of the chair that I was sitting in. His eyes glared down at the ultrasound pictures that Sade was holding in her hands. You see they talking about his two babies in there, ma. I pray to God don't try to be funny and give a nigga two daughters. That shit'll bring me to my fucking knees and have me crying, Corporate said, and Sade waved him off. Those girls are gonna run you, Sade told him. I already know. That's why I want sons, he stated, before reaching over and putting his large hand on my belly. So you can be hard on them. That's why. Colony told me you slammed him, Sade said, and Corporate just shook his head. I'd do the shit again if he ever disrespects Pleasure. I scared the shit out of his ass, so I already know we won't have to worry about that again. I ain't even hard on Colony. Now that we done got out of that awkward stage, he don't give me no problems. Hopefully shit stays that way. I'ma bring his ass in the backyard with me and have him doing drills like Cato used to have us doing, Corporate stated, and he started laughing. I loved when my man laughed because it wasn't something that he often did. A lot of people didn't even know that Corporate had dimples because his mean ass rarely smiled or laughed. So when they just showed, I reached my finger up and poked it. Cato used to kill me with that. Cody wasn't even five, and he had my baby out there doing push-ups, Sade snapped, and then she started laughing because I was sure she started to think about the good times she had with her late husband. Corporate and I stayed in the office with Sade for another 5 minutes or so, and then we went into his office where he promised he would only have me with him for an hour at the most. I already knew his ass was lying, so I went ahead and kicked my shoes off and got comfortable in there. Working alongside him, I started handling some of the paperwork that needed to be taken care of. Later that night when I got home, I was going to put all my girls on a group call so I could share the news with them about my being pregnant with twins. I swear I could already hear the screams in my ear right now from how extra all of their asses were going to be. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, Linda. Oh, child, this is a mess. I'm mad that they seem to be so hard on... Chocolate Z got a picture up. Hey, girl, hey. Let me find out. Okay. Yes. Show us what you're working with, boo. I'm telling y'all, all the bad bitches is over here in the speakeasy. Fuck what you heard. I'm telling you how it is. Baby, when y'all be following me on Instagram, I be looking. I ain't seen nobody ugly yet. I'm still waiting, though. I'm waiting to see somebody ugly. I mean, not to call people ugly, you know, because people can't help what they look like. Shit. But you know what I'm saying. I got all the bad bitches over here. So now look and watch all the niggas start subscribing. Oh, yeah. Or no, ain't no bad bitches over here. Go away. Buck like, yeah, go away. I got the speakeasy on lock. Oh my God. All right, we waiting for the timestamp to count on down. Y'all, I got a new thermos, so my coffee gonna stay hot. Let's hope I'm always able to drink out of this thing. But I had to get a new thermos because that shit was annoying. All right, let me shut the fuck up and get back at it. Chapter 4, Amiri Pierre. Where's my son? My mama screamed with tears in her eyes. It was going on 2 weeks and nobody fucking knew where Aiden was. I'd already called up all his hoes and niggas he ran with and nobody knew shit. I was trying to be positive in this shit and not think the worst, but this shit wasn't like Aiden. The nigga loved our mama, and even though he lived a busy life, he couldn't go a day without sliding to our mama's crib just to sit with her for a couple of hours and eat some of her cooking. We were Haitian men, and y'all know a Haitian man loves his mother, and we swear that they're our girlfriends. My brother was obsessed with our mother, and she had just shown me her phone to let me see that she hadn't talked to him in a couple of weeks. Her reaction to not seeing or hearing from Aiden was scaring the shit out of a nigga, and honestly, all the positive shit that I was on, thinking he was in good hands, was about to be thrown out of the window. I just picked up a shipment from my new plug, Rodriguez, and I had been so busy that I hadn't been calling my brother as much as I used to. So for at least a week, I ain't even know the nigga was missing. When I let work consume me, I tend to check out from the rest of the world, so I hadn't been fucking hoes, checking in with my family, none of that shit. My mom hit me earlier in the week, sounding all irrational, to let me know she hadn't heard from Aiden. My mama was a real-life drama queen, so even with all that fussing and shit she was doing over the phone, I was telling her to relax and that I would look into it. I got distracted with work and let a couple days go by before I decided to hit my brother. His phone went straight to voicemail. From there, I went to the nigga's house, and I ain't see his car in the parking lot of the apartment complex where he resided. I had a spare key to Aiden's apartment, so I used it to let myself in, and the house was squeaky clean with no sign of him. The hoes that I knew he fucked with, I found them on social media and wrote them to see if they'd heard from him, and they all told me that they hadn't spoken to him. I hit the niggas up who ran with Aiden and nobody knew anything. I felt in my spirit that this shit was bad. But again, I was trying to be positive. I would bleed this fucking city red if some bullshit happened to my brother. Well, you better get ready to bleed the city because that nigga got popped in the bathroom stall over there at the Double D, okay? That's what he get for being a rapey McCreep stain, son of a bitch. Anyway. All right. Mommy. Relax. Damn, you stressing me out, yo. I snapped, walking out of her front door to sit on the porch. I'd been over there with her for about an hour, and I was sweating like a motherfucker because she had the air off like she always did. There was a black crate on her porch that I sat on and removed my black shirt along with my white beater because a nigga was sweating too much. While I was over there, I was making calls just to see if anybody had heard anything from my brother, and everybody said the same shit. I was pissed because I was supposed to be somewhere running a fucking business, but mentally I was fucked up and I couldn't focus unless I got some answers on where the fuck Aiden was. If this nigga called me right now, I swear to God I would snap on his black ass for stressing our fucking mama out like this. My phone started vibrating in my hands and it was my nigga Scar hitting me. I was stressed, so I made that shit clear to him and everybody else that I ain't need them to hit me unless they had some news on Aiden. So the fact that he was calling might mean he had something, so I quickly picked up the phone for him on the second ring. "You got something for me?" I asked, getting right to the point. "Yeah, my ears been to the streets and a few niggas are saying that they saw Aiden in Mercy's new club on the night of the grand opening." "Man, who you getting that information from, nigga? You already know Mercy said that we couldn't be in his fucking club, so security wouldn't have even let Aiden through the door," I snapped, ready to hang the phone up on him because already it didn't sound like his story was reliable. "Look, nigga, I'm telling you what the fuck was told to me. They saying they saw Aiden in the fucking club that night. They said that he was ducked off and was by himself. Nigga came in that bitch wearing a hoodie over his head, but they were still able to spot that nigga out and tell that it was him. The shit sounds legit to me. It's almost like Aiden didn't want nobody to know what he planned to do that night, and that's why he didn't hit none of us and tell us that he was going to Mercy's new club. Even the hoes he be fucking didn't have a clue where the nigga was going. From what I heard, them strong motherfuckers were deep as hell in the club that night. Best believe they got something to do with the disappearance of Aiden. I would pull up on Mercy and tell him to show you the footage of the club so you can really see if he came through there or not," Scar told me. I thought about everything he said for a few moments and my leg was steadily bouncing because I honestly didn't know what the fuck to believe. "All right, yo, I'll hit you later," I said, and then hung the phone up. I stood up from the crate that I'd been sitting on and walked inside the house to let my mama know I was leaving, but I was gonna come right back. I ain't even wait for her response. I just got the fuck out the house, jogged over to my car, and quickly got inside with my shirt in my hands. I ain't put my shirt back on until 5 minutes after I started driving and was sitting at a red light. It was Thursday, a little bit after 4 p.m, and Diamonds was already open. I really didn't know which club Mercy would be at, but the clubs weren't far from each other, so I didn't mind having to go by both clubs. If I felt like Mercy was trying to withhold information about my brother and cover up some shit that might have gone down in his club, I was gonna kill that nigga right where the fuck he stood. I mean that shit. I already had been looking at that nigga sideways and feeling like he'd picked his side to be on after he told me and my niggas that we couldn't come to his club anymore, but he didn't keep that energy toward them strong niggas. This was the life of my fucking brother that we were talking about, and somebody would have to feel me. "Boy, don't nobody give a fuck about you, fuck nigga. You just got out of jail. You trying to go back? You miss your boyfriend?" I pulled up to Diamonds first and parked in the designated owner's parking spot. Was a nice-ass gray Rolls Royce that I knew belonged to Mercy. There were a few other cars in the parking lot, and I parked, locked my doors, and headed to the front. where there was just one security guard. His name was Jay, and he had been doing security at Diamonds for years. Everyone knew that when Jay was working the door, he got the line down quick as hell without anyone having to sit and stand in that bitch for an hour. Jay was a cool cat, and I never had any issues with him, but I was on a different kind of timing, so we would see how this shit goes. "What's good, Amiri? You know I can't let you in this shit," Jay said. He wore a black suit and had a walkie-talkie in his hands. "I respect that, but tell Mercy to come outside. I need to holler at him about something." "Mercy having a meeting right now with the crew, getting ready for the night crowd." "Look, Jay, I fuck with you. I swear I do. But I don't give a fuck about none of that shit. Tell that nigga to bring his ass the fuck out here right now because I need to talk to him about something. You know me, nigga. You know I'm a wild guy, and I'll find a way to get inside this motherfucking club. So tell the nigga to bring his ass out here." He sighed, and I watched him pick up the walkie-talkie and page Mercy to bring his ass out there. He told him that I was out there, and I was fired up. Mercy told him to tell me to give him 5 minutes. That was all I needed to hear. I walked away from Jay and posted up on the side of the club, putting my right foot behind me, propped up against the building. I was stressed, and stress caused me to keep smoking blunts, so I reached inside my pants pocket, pulled out a blunt that was already rolled up, and lit it. I could hardly light this bitch the right fucking way because my hand was steadily shaking. My nerves were too fucking bad from not knowing where my brother was. As positive as I wanted to be, I just felt that Aiden was gone. He had a lot of my ways, so I knew there were plenty of niggas who didn't like him, and it really wasn't any telling who had gotten a hold of him and killed him. Everything was just telling me that he was gone. The nigga's phone was off, his black Corvette was missing, and the fact that literally no one had heard from him in a couple of weeks let me know that nothing good would come from this situation. After a few more minutes, I heard the doors to the club open. Mercy walked out, said a few words to Jay, and then he made his way over to me. I could tell from the look on his face that he was aggravated that he had to walk out of a meeting to see what I wanted with him. "What's good, Amiri? I'm in the middle of handling some business right now," he spat, standing in front of me and looking me in the eyes. "Aye, so I'll be quick. When was the last time you saw Aiden?" "I don't know, man. Probably a couple of days before you got into that shit with Chaotic and Cody. What's this about, man?" he wanted to know. I removed my foot from the building and walked over to him, getting in his face. "So my brother wasn't at the grand opening of your new club a couple of weeks ago?" "Nah, security was on it that night, and they knew not to let you or any other nigga that be running with you inside my shit. What the fuck are you trying to ask me, man? I got shit that I need to handle in my club. You out here beating around the bush with these questions. Please go ahead and spit that shit out so I can get back to what the fuck I was doing. I want to see the camera footage from the night of the grand opening at the new club. Show me that, and I'll leave you the fuck alone." "Amiri, look, bruh, I don't know what the fuck you got going on, but you coming down here poking your chest out and talking to me all aggressive like I'm your fucking yes man, and this ain't that, my guy. I don't have no fucking reason to lie about not seeing your brother in my fucking club the night of the grand opening. If Aiden is missing, don't stand your ass here and act like that motherfucker was innocent. You and that nigga been rubbing people the wrong fucking way for years now, and I swung on this nigga, hitting him with my right hand. Then I tossed the blunt on the ground so I could fuck his ass up some more, but Mercy was quick. He swung back on me, and within seconds, this nigga and I were going blow for blow. The crazy thing is, Mercy was well into his 50s, but he fought like a young nigga. Mercy was built like a fucking linebacker, so the jabs he threw my way were quick, and them fucking punches were powerful, too. In the middle of our tussling, Jay ran over. This nigga tackled me, slamming me down on my back, quickly stopping the fight between Mercy and me. "Nigga, is you fucking crazy? You gonna bring your ass down here trying to fucking tussle with me because you looking for answers on what happened to your brother? Now, I would have showed your ass the motherfucking footage from the night of my grand opening, but now I'm not showing your ass shit. Get the fuck off my property, nigga, before I blow your fucking brains out." No lie, I'd never seen this nigga get this angry before. I stood up from the ground and looked at him. "Mercy, if I get some kind of solid proof that my brother was in your club and some shit happened to him in there, and you just trying to cover that shit up, I swear to God I'm coming back and airing this shit out. Make sure you have your best men working the door that night." I went over to my car, got inside, and quickly pulled out. I made it to a red light, and I got so fucking angry that I just repeatedly started hitting the steering wheel. I felt like I was losing my fucking mind. I'd only been home from prison for a few months. My brother and I had so much shit to do together. I'd been locked up for all those years, missing out on a lot of shit. I was supposed to get back out there and hustle and purchase my brother a nice whip, just like he'd surprised me with when I came home. This was our year to stack our money and just go harder than ever before. I kept saying that I could feel the shit in my soul that my brother was gone. I was already mentally preparing myself for that shit, but at the same time, I prayed to God that I had it all wrong. My prayer was that Aiden was just somewhere in a whole other country with a fine bitch, and he'd cut his phone off so they could spend some quality time together. Granted, I already knew my brother didn't do lame shit like that, but this one time I prayed that it was what he had chosen to do. And that's the end of that chapter. Yeah, that nigga, child, listen, he worm food, child. Give it up, turn it loose. Oh, Lord, it's a wrap for your brother. Merry Christmas, nigga, because the gift has been wrapped, and the gift was his death. Yep. Read the card, my guy. It says he dead than a motherfucker. That's what it said. I saw it. All right, let me get this next time stamp, child. I'm going to push it out a little bit because I swear every time I say that shit, it just sounds wrong, yo. It really does. It just sounds all wrong. All right, did I miss anybody coming in? I hope everybody liked the video. Yeah. Oh, Church Lady is most definitely on the list. Ain't no getting off the list. Nope. Mm-mm. You don't get off. You can't get off the list. Once you own the list, you own that bitch. And it's forever until you get, you know, you get your comeuppance. Mm-hmm. Once you get your beaten, that's it. All right, here we go. Let's get it together here. We got about 5 seconds. Mm-mm-mm. Chapter 5, Corporate Strong. It was Friday morning, and I was sitting up in bed with just my pajama bottoms on. I had a coffee mug in my hand that held some coffee that Big Ma had whipped up for me. She was downstairs about to start on breakfast, knowing her crazy-ass granddaughter was going to wake up and fuss at her for cooking breakfast. That was like the main duty that my wife wanted to do around the house, and she didn't want anyone else touching those pots and pans. It was early, a little bit after 6 a.m, and I knew that Pleasure's alarm was about to go off in a few short moments. She used to be up each morning by 5 to get an early morning workout in, but the pregnancy had her moving slowly these days. Now she got up each morning by 6:15, got herself together, and then headed downstairs to get started on breakfast. Once Colony and I were out the door, that's when she would head to the gym in the basement, get her workout in, and then come back upstairs to shower and get ready to start the day. I meant what I said about having my wife sit down from this business shit until we got shit under control out there. Shit was too hot, and I ain't want Pleasure running the streets with me while pregnant. I was keeping her away from company meetings and all that shit. At most, I would let her go out and handle shit at the office buildings we owned together, picking up checks and light shit like that, but that was it. Mercy already hit me last night telling me how Amiri had come down to Diamonds, popping shit to him, demanding to know where his brother was. If the nigga was anything like me and was able to do simple math and put 2 and 2 together, he'd eventually find out who was responsible for that shit. The petty nigga in me wanted to send out a clue, putting that shit out there that his brother was dead and gone, but also wanted to know that the nigga was out there sweating, dying to know where Aiden was, so I was gonna chill. Pleasure's alarm went off and she groaned with her eyes closed. She was lying on her side of the bed, facing me with her eyes still closed. The blanket rested at her waist, so I was able to see her naked body because my wife didn't sleep with clothes on. I glared at her beautiful, succulent titties, and my eyes dropped to her stomach as well. I found myself smiling since she was carrying my 2. I ain't gonna lie, when the doctor said that shit to us, I almost passed the fuck out. But then I had to tell myself that Pleasure carrying my twins was a big blessing, and I wanted to be appreciative of that shit. A few days ago, Pleasure and I got into it because she felt like a nigga hadn't been as attentive and like I hadn't been taking her on dates and shit. I wanted her to know that a nigga was hearing her, and that's why, even though that alarm was going off, my baby had options right now on whether she should get up or not. At 5 this evening, we were going to head out. I was taking my wife to Fiji. Oh, he heard her, y'all. He taking her to Fiji. I'd booked everything yesterday because I felt like that shit wasn't fair to Pleasure to deprive her of a good trip because of the outside shit that I was dealing with. In this life that I lived, it was always going to be some bullshit, and if I waited around for shit to be smooth sailing, we'd be waiting forever. I'd already told Sade to watch Colony for me because we'd be gone for an entire week. Kanye was scheduled to head this way at around 10 because I knew Pleasure would want her hair done before we left. Her nail appointment and all that shit were already taken care of. Had to show my wife that a nigga was trying because the last thing I needed was her falling out of love with me. Corporate, I don't want to get up, she whined. Her eyes were still closed, but we were so in tune with each other that she could probably just feel that a nigga was staring down at her. I laughed as I reached over and placed my hand on her belly. "You don't have to, beautiful. Go back to sleep then," I responded as I rubbed her stomach. She just groaned some more and then she sat up in bed. There were beautiful red roses at the foot of the bed that caused pleasure to squeal because her ass loved some red roses. I'd given this woman so many fucking red roses over the years that she could have opened her own nursery. On occasions like Valentine's Day or her birthday, I swear I would go all out with the roses, feeding into her addiction. She reached over, grabbed the beautiful bouquet, and smelled them as she held them in her hands. "Thank you, baby, and good morning. I love you so much," she cooed and scooted over so she could quickly tongue kiss me. I was no longer holding the coffee mug, so as we kissed, my hands held onto her full breast, gently massaging her nipples and getting her turned on, although I knew she wasn't gonna let me fuck. I was losing that bold bitch who lived inside of pleasure because her ass was trying to be mindful of Big Mon Colony being in the house, so she'd been holding off on where I could get the pussy and when. Man, it used to be a time when I could walk my ass in the kitchen, pull her shorts and her panties down, and slide right in. These days, she wouldn't dare let a nigga get away with that shit because she was scared that we were gonna get caught. Right when the kiss was feeling good, she pulled away. I proceeded to suck on her neck, which had her tossing her head back. Right when she started moaning, she damn near ran away from me and went to her side of the bed. "Bae, come on. Colony's down the hall, and I don't know where Big Ma is. You'll be trying to embarrass me," she whined, and that shit made me laugh. "I'd be embarrassing you, baby. Come here. P, I got morning wood. Can I please get my dick rolled at 6 in the morning? Come on. We used to do fun shit like that all the time," I bribed her. I reached my hand out, trying to grab her ass, but she kept scooting back, and I had to scoot closer. I grabbed her by both arms, and she yelped for me to stop, but I already had her. I lifted her and set her down on my morning wood so she could feel how hard that shit was. "Used to break your fucking neck to sit on some morning dick," I reminded her as I had my hands on her bare ass. "That's when it was just you and me. And baby, come on. I gotta cook breakfast. I gotta head to all the office buildings today, too. Also, it's Friday. You have meetings today," she reasoned. "Nah, we ain't gotta do none of that shit today," I let her know. "Why we don't? Who gonna do it for us?" she inquired, looking at me like I was crazy. "We leaving for Fiji at 5. I revealed. She laughed while rolling her eyes and trying to get up from my lap. I slapped her on her ass twice and leaned in, putting my lips right on her breast, where I proceeded to suck her nipples. Pleasure's titties were so fucking pretty, and they were nice and full to the point that I couldn't keep my lips off of them. "I don't believe you. Corporate, come on," she said, with her hand on the back of my head in an attempt to stop me from sucking her nipples. I flicked my tongue on her right one, doing that shit nice and slow as I looked up at her. "I swear on my 3, I responded, referring to my 3 kids. Pleasure knew I wouldn't lie about no shit like that, even though 2 of the kids weren't even here yet. "Baby, for real? You swear?" she squealed, and I could hear the excitement in her voice. Pleasure was carrying on like I was a nigga who just went around lying to her ass because she wasn't trying to hear shit a nigga was saying to her. I reached over, grabbed my phone from the nightstand, and went to my email, showing her the confirmation for the resort that I'd booked for us last night. I passed her the phone, and she looked at it with a big-ass smile on her face. Then she tossed the phone on the bed while she wrapped her arms around my neck, proceeding to thank me over and over for doing this and telling me how much she needed this vacation. From there, it was on, and her ass was the one kissing and sucking on my neck this time. "Oh, so now I get some pussy, now that you see I booked a trip. Ain't this a bitch?" I said, causing her to laugh. "I'm still not giving you no pussy, Corporate. Just some head right quick," she shot. Beggars couldn't be choosers, so I put my head against the headboard as I prepared myself for that deep throat that Pleasure was about to put on me. I knew my wife well enough to know that, along with her being scared to let me fuck because my son was down the hall, along with her grandma being downstairs, she was also holding out on giving me the pussy because, truth be told, a pussy was probably sore. I was in that shit all night last night, so I was sure she could use a break, and I was gonna chill and give her one. The kisses that she placed on my abs, followed by dragging her tongue down until she got to the head of my dick, which was sticking up in the air through my brief, felt so fucking good. Pleasure was a pro at sucking dick, so a nigga was damn near moaning, and she hadn't even started showing me her real skills yet. With just her hands on my abs, she used her teeth to pull the band of my briefs down, and my dick popped right out. She placed light kisses along the head, licked up the pre-cum, and showed me that shit in her mouth. Then she swallowed me whole, giving me some nice slow head, knowing I was a sucker for that shit. I put my right hand on the top of her head, easing her head up and down on my shit as I released slow grunts. "Fuck, baby. Get a nigga right," I said in a low, deep voice, keeping my hand on the back of her head. She let her mouth go all the way down, stuffing my dick in her mouth, allowing herself to gag and lose her breath for a few seconds. All that spit she had in her mouth, she released on the dick and went back to sucking me. The kicker was her keeping her eyes on me as she did that nasty-ass shit. She was making a lot of gurgling noises and big, sloppy-ass mess, but that's when head was the best. She kept that energy going for about 2 minutes straight, and before I knew it, I was the one to break the staring match because I tossed my head back, keeping my hand on her head, and I started nutting. You would think that I was backed up from the amount of semen that I just shot in her mouth, but we'd gone for at least 4 rounds last night. My favorite drink, her nasty ass called out after she licked the nigga clean. I scooted down in the bed until I was on my back, and I told my wife to come here. Pleasure knew what I wanted, so it wasn't long before she sat all that ass right on my chest and opened her legs. I leaned my head in and started eating her. I had to get her right. Shit wasn't fair for her to not be able to bust a nut after she just allowed me to bust this fat one. I was able to get a hold of her clit with just my lips, and I held it captive, sucking on that shit nice and slow, driving her ass crazy. My hands were on her nipples, stimulating them and giving her pleasure times two. Ooh. Corporate, baby, eat me just like that, she cried as she ground her pussy on my face, trying to be the one in control of her nut. I slurped, licked, and kissed all over her pussy, and when I felt her body pause and start shaking, I went to work on her clit. Seconds later, she was coming and running away from my tongue. She moved just before I could get her ass to squirt. I lay back on the bed looking at her with her pussy juices at the corners of my mouth. I could feel that shit in my beard, too. She stood up from the bed, walked over to me, and cuffed my jaw with her right hand. Then she tongue-kissed me so she could taste her own juices. Then she pulled away. Lord, have mercy on your pussy when we get to Fiji. We're going to be trying all kinds of shit. Pack the rolls, bring the vibrators, bring the negligee, all that shit, I let her know. She laughed while rolling her eyes at me. I'm leaving that rose right here. I can't enjoy sex the way I want to with the rose. 20 seconds in and I'm already releasing my first orgasm and then I get lazy on you, so the rose stays. I bring my vibrator though, she assured me. I knew exactly where she kept the rose store, so I was going to pack that shit in my own suitcase. It was no competing with that fucking rose. Trust me, I've tried, but that shit was impossible. That little fucker was a silent killer. And while a lot of women love that shit, my wife hated it. She hated how fast she would get her orgasm. And after she released, she would get lazy on a nigga. I love that shit, though. I had to go in with that motherfucker, using a towel, though. Shit'll soak up the entire bed. I eventually got up from the bed and went into the bathroom to brush my teeth. Pleasure was already inside doing the same shit. She brushed her teeth, washed her face, and then got in the shower. I joined her, but I ain't even touch her. I let her keep her pussy to herself because I already knew she was going to be in for a rude awakening with me once we got to Fiji. She ended up staying in the shower longer because I told her that Kanye was coming to do her hair, so she wanted to wash it. When I was done, I stepped out, put a towel around me, and went into our bedroom. I dried off, threw on a fresh pair of briefs, some basketball shorts, and a wife beater. My house shoes were by the bed, so I quickly slipped them on. I was the one to make up the bed, and once that was done, pause, make it up. You mean as in fresh sheets, change the linen, nigga? Because that's what needs to happen. All the fucking, and so y'all went 4 rounds last night, and everybody busting and shit all over the bed again this morning. Tink, sir, you need to change them goddamn sheets. That's nasty. You nasty. All right, let me be quiet. And once that was done, I walked out of the room to check on Colony. He had his bedroom door open, and when I spotted him, he was quickly closing up his book bag that he had resting on his gaming chair. What's good? Remember, Sade gonna get you from school. Me and P going out of town, I let him know. All right, you know I can drive, right? Why you don't let me push one of your whips to school? That's lame as hell, man, having people drop me off and pick me up from school. I ain't had that done since middle school. Xavier said you can't drive worth a damn, I said, and that shit made him laugh. She just scary, that's all. I drive fast. If I get my Florida license, you'll cop me a car. I think about it. I don't trust your ass, son. I can see you being reckless while driving, I told him, and he shook his head. Nah, I ain't gonna be doing all that. You thought about what I asked you the other day? He questioned, switching the subject just that fast. I knew what he was referring to, but I was gonna pretend that I didn't. Nah, what you asked me the other day? About Nani. She can come here for spring break? He asked. Man, I don't know about all that. Something about a nigga that don't pay no bills here fucking girls in my house that I ain't cool with. How old is that girl anyway? Her mama just gonna let her fly down here for spring break and be with you for a whole week? Man, her mama don't give a damn what she do. Pops, I used to stay the night at her crib for weeks at a time. Shit, that won't be my fucking daughter. Let me think about that, man. You tripping, I told him, and he shook his head. All right, then, at the most, I got some money and I'll cop us a room for the week. Pops, that's my girl, and I haven't seen her in months. I gotta do some special shit for her. And I thought if anybody understood, you would, because you in love, too. That last comment had me laughing. You in love, little nigga? I questioned. Shit, I think I am. I walked in on you last night in the kitchen, and the girl you was on FaceTime with didn't look like Nani, but that ain't none of my business, though. Finish getting ready, and I'll drop you off at school, I said, and then slapped it up with him. I walked out of the room and went downstairs where Big Mom was in the kitchen, but she was using a cane to help her get around. Wow, that's a shame. After the stroke, I made good on my promise and had her move in with us. The chances of her having another stroke were high, and if that shit would have happened, I would rather someone be home with her when it did. You know Big Mom had a whole fucking fit once she learned that she had to move in with us, but she also knew that we weren't giving her much of a choice, so even with all that attitude, she brought her ass on over. Pleasure wasn't playing that shit with her grandma, man. She had her on a strict diet, and since she'd been with us, she'd already lost 10 pounds. All right, now, that's what I'm talking about. We had a physical therapist come over to get in a little exercise with her. With the meds she was taking and the new lifestyle that we'd given her, Big Mom's blood pressure had been good. We hoped it would stay that way because, like I told a doctor at the hospital, we need Big Mom to stick around for at least 20 more years. Where's my grandbaby? She asked, referring to Pleasure. The two of them loved each other so much, they got on each other's damn nerves, but their love for each other was so pure. Big Mom was standing at the stove and she had some oatmeal going. I knew she was whipping that up for nobody but Colony because his ass loved some oatmeal and he would load it up with cinnamon and sugar. She in the shower. She should be down soon. Hey, when you go over there with Rhodesia this afternoon, you need to keep the same shit going over there as you have been doing over here. Don't be sneaking soda or none of that shit, I said, sounding like I was the elder. Big Mom sucked her teeth and waved me off like she always did whenever someone said some shit to her that she didn't want to hear. Big Mom and I had a nice-ass relationship. This was my girl, and we'd been cool ever since I came into the picture. I took a seat at the island, and within a couple of moments, she set a hot bowl of oatmeal in front of me, which I thanked her for. Colony came downstairs later and walked over to Big Mom. He hugged her and took a seat next to me in front of his bowl of oatmeal. Pleasure joined us moments later, and her wet hair was pushed up with a clip that was keeping it together. She walked in wearing a gray top that fit like a half shirt with matching gray tights, and she had her house shoes on her feet. She looked good enough to fucking eat, and she smelled even better. My eyes zeroed in on her ass while she went over to Big Mom and kissed on her cheek. "Who you fixing that for, Ma?" Pleasure asked, because Big Mom was holding a bowl in her hands, getting ready to put some oatmeal in it. You need to feed those babies. She snapped. Now, you know I don't do oatmeal, Ma. You oatmealed me to death when I was living with you, so don't even try it. I'll just make me an omelet, Pleasure objected. Okay, sit down and I'll make it, Big Ma said. I could tell by the look on my wife's face that she wanted to challenge her grandmother by cooking her own food, but they were two stubborn-ass women, and I was glad Pleasure threw in the towel and allowed Big Ma to fix her food. She stood off to the side with her back posted against the kitchen counter, and she folded her arms as she looked over at her grandma before glaring at me. Bae, who we leaving Mom with while we're gone? Pleasure asked. She said she want to go with Rhodesia, I responded, almost done with my oatmeal. Pleasure made a face like she ain't like the sound of that. I don't like that. Mom, Rhodesia be giving you soda and shit. She lets you get away with stuff that I don't, and that's why you want to go over there, Pleasure fussed. Pleasure, please. Stop treating me like I'm some hard-headed child and you're the adult. I'm not going to be eating anything that I don't have any business eating. I almost died for the second time, and that was enough to scare the shit out of me. I'm walking around here with a cane because I'm not as strong as I used to be. You don't think I know what I'm not supposed to be eating or drinking? Go on now. she snapped at Pleasure and did the signature eye roll that Pleasure liked to do. That's who my wife got that bullshit from in the first place. I hated that rolling eyes bullshit, and it probably annoyed me so fucking bad because I grew up witnessing that shit with Sade. My mother was the queen of rolling her big ass fucking eyes. Kato used to threaten to put them bitches out and set them on the table. Years later, I got myself a wife who did the same fucking bullshit. Pleasure eventually dropped it, and then she came over and talked with Colony for a little while. She hugged him and then kissed me on my lips and hugged me as well before we went out the door. I needed this fucking vacation, man. Life had been stressful as fuck these days, and I just wanted to sit back and run my feet in some nice-ass sand on the beach while I watched my wife prance around in little to no fucking clothing as she drank her non-alcoholic cocktails. I deserve that shit. And there's a break in the chapter. Listen, fuck, this chapter is 34 minutes long, and I just hit the halfway mark. I mean, fucking bloody hell. Listen, I'm over here sounding like a British narrator. Bloody hell. Shit. Oh, my God. Mm-mm. Ooh, y'all. This little thermos is working. This shit's still hot, y'all. Ooh, I like it. I like it. Okay. Let me get my ass back to reading because it was a little breaky break. Did I miss anything relevant? Like anybody coming in? Wait, Buck said, hey, look, you got to have 100% energy like a video game to compete with that. No, God. You said that with your chest, Buck. Oh, right. You better get you some 5-hour energy. Right. He said that shit like he was mad. Like one time a rose put him to shame or some shit. Oh, my God, today. Listen. Yeah, you gotta start doing your push-ups and your sit-ups and, you know, eating clean and shit. Yep, you gotta do all that shit. Otherwise, you ain't gonna be able to keep up, hell. All right. Let me get back at it here. A few hours later, my barber had just pulled the cape off after giving me a nice-ass lineup when my phone started buzzing in my pockets. I wasn't in a rush to pull it out because I was going in my pocket to get some money to pay my barber cash. This nigga had been cutting my hair for over 10 years, and he was the only nigga I trusted with them clippers on me. I sat in that nigga's chair at least once a week to have a perfect lineup. Child, listen. Wait a minute. What? No, I just wasn't prepared to go hard that night. Oh, to go that hard that night. Yeah, Whatever you say, Buck. I'm going to let you have that one, though. Appreciate that, Corp. You and wifey be safe. Y'all going to love Fiji, man. Me and the wife went last year for our 10-year wedding anniversary, Cash told me. While he was cutting me, I shared a little with him about the trip that I was taking my wife on. Cash married his high school sweetheart, Kalisha. They have 4 kids together, and I love their union. Nigga loved his wife just as much as I loved mine. Before my life got so fucking crazy, we would double date on a few occasions, but shit had been so complicated lately that we hadn't had the time to do it like we used to. Pleasure was cool with Kalisha. They had a nice relationship. Why we ain't never heard about this bitch? We in book 3 and we don't even know who the fuck Kalisha is. So they can't be too fucking cool, sir, or else the bitch would have been in one of the books, but okay. They'd met through Cash and me. All right, man, I'll hit you when I get back. Be easy, I called out as I slapped it up with him. I tipped him well, just as I always did, and as I was walking out of the shop, my phone started buzzing again. This time, I went into my pocket and pulled it out. My heart started beating fast as fuck once I saw that it was Colony School that was calling me. Usually, when I got phone calls from his school, it was after school hours, and it would just be automatic messages from the school reminding the parents of any upcoming events. They'd never called me in the middle of the day like this, and that's why a nigga was kind of nervous. Granted, Colony hadn't been having any problems in school, so I hoped I was just jumping the gun and overreacting a bit. Hello, I answered. Hello, this is Principal Gina. Is this Mr. Strong? The principal of the school asked. I was standing outside my car wanting to see how this conversation would go before I got in, I think is what he meant. Or she meant, because it said before I four in. Yeah, that was a little, Anyway, something told me that I needed to stand my ass up for the shit she was getting ready to say to me. Yes, what's going on? My son straight? I asked. That question had her sighing, which let me know that this was about to be some bullshit. Mr. Strong, your son brought a gun to school today. One of the students saw it when he went into his backpack to retrieve something, and they came to the office to let us know. He has since then been pulled out of class, and he's been taken into police custody. The principal told me. Man, what the fuck? What the fuck he took a gun to school for? I snapped. I wasn't really asking the principal because I doubted that she could get into Colony's mind and answer that fucking question for me. I was gonna fucking kill that nigga. All I could think about this morning when I walked into his bedroom and the nigga quickly closed his book bag when he saw me walk in. I swear I didn't think anything of it because I didn't think he would do some dumbass shit like that. I was the one who dropped this nigga off at school this morning and we had a whole fucking conversation about his senior year coming up and his plans for after high school. This was some bullshit, man. Look, Mr. Strong, Colony seems to be a good kid. I see him around campus and he usually sticks to himself. I pulled up his grades and he's passing all his classes with all A's. But the real issue here is that he brought a weapon onto school property and that kind of act is not accepted. He caused the entire school to go under lockdown. Kids have been calling and texting their parents. So there are hundreds of angry parents standing outside the school demanding their children be let out. But we're still under investigation. Colony will have to be expelled from the school for this, she went on to say. I just hung the phone up on her ass, got in my car, and backed out of the parking lot. I was about to call my wife in hopes that I could catch her before she left to go to her nail appointment. I called, and she answered on the second ring. Hey, baby, she answered. You still at the house? Yes, but I'm getting ready to walk out the door. What's going on? Check downstairs in some of the gun stashes and see which one is missing. Okay, Corporate, what happened, though? I sucked my teeth, really wanting to tell her to stop asking fucking questions and to just check the fucking stashes, but she had every right to want to know what the fuck was going on. Colony took a fucking gun to school. The principal just called me. What? Oh my God. What the fuck, Colony? Baby, the Glock in the kitchen is missing. He had to take it out of here late last night. I just saw it in here yesterday evening when I was cooking. Why the fuck did he take a gun to school? Pleasure screamed the same damn question that I'd screamed when I was on the phone with the principal, but no one seemed to have answers to that shit. Man, I don't know. They holding him in police custody. Hopefully, they gave his stupid ass a bond so I can bail him out. By the time I get done with this nigga, he gonna wish they had kept his ass. That gun is clean. It don't have any bodies on it, and it's registered to me. We gonna be straight, I shared. Okay, I'm gonna just stay here. Let me know what happens. We can just postpone the trip. I ain't postponing shit. This nigga wants to be fucking stupid and bring a gun to school. That's on his ass. I ain't letting him fuck up a trip for my wife and me. Go get your nails and shit done, P. I'ma handle him, I said, and then hung up. I swear the second I hung up with her, Nene started calling me. I was angry, so at first I wasn't gonna pick up. But then it hit me that Nene could have been at the jail and maybe she saw Colony. What's good, Nene? Corporate, they just brought Colony in here. He has a possession of a firearm charge. I literally just walked in here to bring in a juvenile, and I saw Colony waiting in one of the cells. You knew about this? You could hear in her voice how concerned she was. Yeah, man, the principal at his school just called me. I'm on the way to get him now. Can you find out if he even has a bond before I take my ass down there and waste my time? Swear I want to be on some fucking petty shit and leave his black ass right in there. The only reason I'm really coming is that I want the fuck the nigga up and find out why he took my fucking gun to school. I was pissed off. This nigga was 17 years old, which I felt was a good enough age to use your motherfucking brain. Why the fuck did he feel that shit was okay to take my fucking gun to school? What if I was a reckless nigga who didn't toss out my dirty guns? Can you imagine if the gun he'd taken with him to school had a few bodies on it? This shit wouldn't have ended well for anyone, and I would have been trying to kill that nigga if I got some prison time for bodies coming back to me. There I was, thinking this nigga and I were forming a bond, and I was making him comfortable enough to talk to me about anything. Then he goes behind my back and does some dumbass shit like this. Hold on, let me see, Nene said, and then she put me on hold. I slowed down on the way that I was driving because if she came back on the line and told me that he didn't have a bond, there was no going, or there wasn't going to be shit I could do. So I was going to leave his ass right the fuck there. About 5 minutes later, Nene came back on the line. There's a $1,000 bond for one count of possessing a weapon on the school property. Then there's a $10,000 bond for the disruption of operations at the school and another $10,000 bond for the firearm charge. Ugh, and he has priors, Corporate. You got to get him a good lawyer because they may try to give his ass some time, Nene told me, saying what I'd been thinking about on the drive over there. Colony had never been hit with the possession of a firearm charge, but after having a long talk with him a few weeks ago, I learned of the charges he had for running away. He had a couple of marijuana possession charges, and the dumbass nigga even had a charge for burglary that he swore he wasn't part of and was just being the lookout man. The nigga seemed to be going out of his fucking way to ruin his life. He wasn't even 18 yet, and his record was already so fucking dirty. I hated this shit for him, but at the same time, I couldn't wait more for the nigga if he didn't want. Okay, sorry. Not wait, want. I couldn't want more for the nigga if he didn't. Yeah, I already know. I'm about to go hit up a bail bondsman now. Handle that, and then I'll come and bail him out. I ain't gonna act like Colony is this perfect-ass kid, because Nene, I already know the kind of young nigga that I'm dealing with, but at the same time, I'm trying to make it make sense on why in the fuck this nigga would take my gun to school. He already told me that he don't have any beef with anybody out there at the school. He said he keeps to himself, so what was the fucking reason, yo? I vented. I don't know, Corporate. You gotta have a talk with him when you pick him up. Listen, I also know that you're angry, but don't come down here fighting with him because they'll be quick to slap some cuffs on you and take you to jail your damn self, she told me. I hear you, was all I said. P called me this morning. She said you were taking her to Fiji. Does this mean you're gonna postpone the trip now? Nene wanted to know. Hell no, I'm still taking my wife on a trip. She deserves this shit. I ain't gonna take a good trip away from her because this nigga wanna be stupid. Nene agreed with me and told me that she probably wouldn't be at the jail by the time I got there, so she told me to calm down and call her later to let her know what happened after my talk with Colony. Well, when he tell him, he ain't gonna be mad, y'all. I'm sure of that, because he only took her because the little white boy was talking about shooting up the school. Not that that makes any goddamn sense, because he should have just told his parents and stayed his ass at home. But anyway, I was thankful for Nene because I would have been annoyed by having to get to the jail to find out what the bond was, only to leave, handle my business with the bail bondsman, and then come right back. Now that I already knew what his bail and shit were, I could just handle that first and go right to the jail. After handling everything with the bail bondsman, I was now at the jail, sitting in a room waiting for them to bring Colony out. My leg was bouncing up and down like a motherfucker because my ass was angry and I couldn't control my nerves. If my wife had been around me, this was usually when she would put her hand on my thigh to stop it from bouncing. Since I'd been there... What the fuck was that? Is that you? Hold on, y'all. Jesus Christ. Okay, sorry, y'all. All right. Since I'd been there, Pleasure had already called me twice, wanting to hear if I had some kind of update. But because I knew Pleasure, I knew she was calling to make sure that I hadn't killed Colony for his fuck-up. By then, Pleasure had already called Sade and told her what happened, so my mama was hitting me every 5 minutes, wanting to know what was going on, too. I'd been waiting out there for about 30 minutes when the doors finally opened and Colony walked out. He was carrying a big-ass plastic bag and it had everything inside that would usually be in his book bag. This morning, he had on a hoodie with his khaki uniform bottoms, but now the hoodie was off and he had on his school uniform shirt with the same khaki bottoms and a crisp pair of white forces on his feet. His locks were hanging and he had the nerve to come out mugging like he was the one that pissed off that he just interfered with everyone's fucking day because of his dumbass fuck up. They weren't going to hand me back that gun because it was now evidence, and I was already told that he would have to see a judge next month. I already knew which lawyer I was going to use for him, too. None other than Alicia Jackson. She was a beast in the courtroom, and she helped get Cody off a few years ago when he had a possession charge. I was cool with her husband, Montana. That nigga and I went way back. As mad as I was at Colony, I was going to get him a good-ass attorney so my boy didn't have to sit and serve any time. When he walked out, I ain't even address his ass. I just simply stood up from my chair and walked out of the room. If I said anything, those officers were going to feel like Colony wasn't safe coming home with me and would have tried to arrest my ass just like Nene told me over the phone. As I walked, I could feel him on my track. We eventually made it into the parking lot where I unlocked my car doors and we quickly got inside. Pops, nah, don't say shit, nigga. What do you want out of life, homie? You need bragging rights or something? You want to be able to get on the phone with your dumbass niggas back home in Atlanta and boast about bringing a fucking gun to school, being carried out in handcuffs, and being hauled off to jail? That shit cool to you, man? You ruining your fucking name, man. I had to fucking fight to get your ass into that fucking private school because as soon as they saw that you had a record, them crackers didn't want you going there. I'm thinking that if I change up the environment of people that I had you around, that you would change up a little bit, but you still doing some of the same dumbass shit that your ass was doing in Atlanta. What's it gonna take with you, man, huh? Bruh, you'll be 18 in a year. If you fuck up then, it ain't gonna be no more cute-ass, time-out-ass, juvenile detention centers for your ass. They gonna throw your ass in a fucking big boy jail, and let's see how your scary ass do with that. Man, you don't even know why I brought the gun to school in the first place, he snapped. What? What was the fucking reason? I wanted to know. On Monday, when I was in the locker room taking a shower, I overheard these seniors talking, and one of them was saying how he was going to shoot the school up on Friday. He was mad because of a low grade that he got, and he said he's been getting bullied all 4 years that he's been at the school. So today was supposed to be the day that he shot the school up. Look, I wasn't trying to get caught lacking, so I took your stick just in case I had to use it as protection. I ain't just take that shit just to take it. I forgot I had that shit on me in my fourth period, and I went to open my book bag too quickly, and the white bitch who sits next to me saw it. 10 minutes later, she asked the teacher if she could use the restroom. I already knew she was gonna snitch, and that's when the cops came and escorted me out of the class. My bad, man. Colony, ain't no my bad in this kind of sticky-ass situation, my guy. You fucked up for real this time. You already got priors, and any judge is gonna look at your record and feel like you're one hard-headed-ass nigga who needs to really learn from your fuck-ups. It's a chance your ass may have to serve some time. If you overheard them niggas talking about shooting up the school, why wouldn't you have said something to somebody about it? I ain't no snitch, man, he said, and I sucked my teeth at that bullshit. Yeah, your ass is a damn fool. That's what you is. You could have told that shit to me or P. And Pleasure picked you up from school Monday. When I came home, she was telling me about the good conversation y'all had at dinner. Nigga, that would have been the perfect time to tell P the shit that you heard. She would have taken her ass out there to that school and handled it before I could even make a move. Talking about you ain't no snitch. Nigga, what if bruh had made good on that threat and came into that school and shot up some shit? Innocent students and teachers would have died and that shit would have been able to go down because Colony don't want to be a snitch. Nigga, you could have been a hero, but I guess that shit ain't gangster enough for you, huh? I snapped. I had to stop talking because the more I talked, the angrier I got, and I wanted to pound on this nigga, so I just dropped it. We drove in silence to Sade's house. Once we arrived, I told the nigga to get out and go knock on the door. Sade was home, but I knew that she was getting ready to leave soon because I was putting her in charge of all the meetings and shit today. She would just take Colony along with her and have him sit in her office or something while she handled business. As I sat out there, I picked my phone up and called Xavier. She had the right to know about what had gone down today with Colony. I probably should have called her as soon as I got off the phone with the principal, but it was so much going on at the time that I just didn't. Hey, her soft voice came over the other end of the line. I just bailed Colony out of jail. I heard her suck her teeth before responding. For what, Corporate? What the fuck did he do? Dumbass took a gun to school. And you bailed him out? You should have left his ass right there. That's why he continues to do all the dumbass shit that he does, because he knows that somebody's always going to be there to get him out of those situations. The last two times he got arrested, he knew he couldn't call me because I made it clear that I wasn't bailing his ass out of jail anymore for doing dumbass shit. And that's why he called his uncle. Whose gun did he take? She was hyped up, but I was gonna let her have that. At the end of the day, she had 17 years to deal with that shit. Pause. By her fucking choice, she should have been fucking told you when the bitch found out she was pregnant. So dead that shit, corporate. The fuck? Act like she had to do it by herself. Ain't no victims here. This bitch volunteered to be a single fucking mother. Or at least to be an unassisted single mother. The fuck? So I was sure this was just a lot on her to have to hear right now. Man, he took that shit out of the kitchen drawer, I said, and that had her sucking her teeth again. It's like at this point, I should have left him with my uncle because leaving him with you really wasn't any better. He's still doing dumb shit. I had to laugh at that shit to keep from cursing her dumb ass the fuck out because I already wasn't in the best of moods. Hey, fuck you and his bitch ass uncle. That nigga in better fucking hands with me than he'll be with anybody. Ask Colony when the fuck was the last time he skipped school. Bet he'll tell you that it was back when he was in Atlanta. He brought home his interim report card the other day and he got all A's with no tardies or absences. He not fucking trying me the way he was trying you or the way he would try your soft ass brother. So chill the fuck out with that bullshit. He made a dumb ass mistake, but don't sit your ass there and try to blame that shit on me. He's 17 years old. He got the good sense to know that he wasn't supposed to touch my fucking gun, let alone bring that shit to school. Whatever, corporate. I'll be there next month. I'm coming down for my friend's birthday, but I'm going to get in town earlier to spend some time with him. I want to meet Pleasure as well. I call Colony, though. Cuss his ass the fuck out, too, because I feel like I didn't go as hard as I wanted to. I snapped, and I heard her laugh. Corporate, Colony is not going to answer the phone for me because he knows I'm going to call him to do exactly what you just told me to do. I'll see his ass when I get there and get in his ass then. All right, then, I responded. We left it at that, and then I hung the phone up. What the fuck? Pause. Why she want to meet Pleasure? Girl, fuck you. Your son is damn near grown. What you think Pleasure gonna do? Put something in the little nigga food or something? This ain't no baby, ma'am. This is a damn near grown-ass man. You got a whole lot of fucking nerve. You done fucked this boy up for the last 17 years, you raggedy bitch. Self-centered cockhole. Anyway, I got out of the car about 15 minutes later because I had to call P and tell her what happened. She kept asking me where Colony was, like I'd killed a nigga or something. When I walked into Sade's house, I could hear her in the kitchen snapping on Colony as I stood in the foyer. I was glad she was doing that shit because Sade was a soft-ass grandma. She always got on me, telling me that I was being too hard on Colony. Even the way she was snapping on Colony was soft because had that been me or one of my brothers who had taken Kato's gun to school, she would have beat the fuck out of us. Shit like that was why I needed this motherfucking vacation. The motherfuckers I loved to death were the same ones stressing a nigga the fuck out. When we got to Fiji, I needed some good-ass Cuban cigars, some dark liquor, and P had to come with the pussy. I wanted pussy every day of the trip. I was trying to fall asleep inside the pussy and wake up in that motherfucker, too. I needed that before I lost my fucking mind. And that's the end of that chapter. Hey, Peanut, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. I was just asking where you were, child. Just looking for your little square head ass. All right, let me, girl, I don't got. Now, see, it's something about when I open up the fucking phone, I don't know what the fuck is going on. I'm not understanding why. It's got to be these motherfuckers that's doing this shit. Because I know it's not my Samsung phone.
Here comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Thank you for the tip, sweet November. She said, for your commentary, comedy, and wisdom. Thank you, boo, for the tip. I appreciate you, darling. Thank you so much.
Here comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Okay, thank you, sweet coconut. Look, I got sweet November and sweet coconut. Y'all, I must be so sweet. Everybody getting a toothache, child. Thank you for the tip, sweet coconut. She said for thank you and a heart emoji. Well, you are welcome, boo. And thank you for the tip, darling. I appreciate you. Child, listen, up here tearing my fucking throat up to bring these good-ass sexy novels to y'all. Thank y'all for tipping me. Y'all have manners, and that's showing appreciation for all my hard work. I appreciate y'all. All right, so let me give y'all another chapter here because, it's only 8 o'clock. Okay. We got a little time. Oh, you know what? I know what I'm about to do. I am about to take a quick little break, y'all, because y'all know I drink a gallon of water a day, child. And I know y'all don't want your girl sitting in a puddle, right? So let me get this time stamp, child, for the break. All right, and then I'll be right back. So y'all give me just 1 second here. I'll be right back. Thank y'all for your patience, my bladder, and I appreciate you. All right. Chapter 6, chaotic strong. I'll let you know. All right. Bae, try my drink. It's really good, Tanisha said as she pushed the fishbowl cup my way, which was filled with a lot of different fruity-ass flavors. On top of the alcohol that was already in the drink, she had our waitress give her a double shot of Casamigos. I ain't want to act like I was her daddy or some shit because Tanisha was a grown-ass woman at the end of the day, but when we placed our orders, I tried to convince her not to get the fishbowl and to get a smaller size drink because I wasn't trying to have her get drunk on a nigga tonight. When Tanisha got drunk, she'd be on that fucking bullshit. She'd already been taking shots with her girls and smoking a couple of hours ago when I picked her up. Then we went to the improv out here in Dania Beach and watched a comedy show where her ass had two drinks. Now we were right next door at 14 North, which was a spot that she and I would frequently hit up together, and her ass was drinking some more. Well, damn, that bitch got problems. Fuck she got going on. Good googly moogly. That's crazy. She drinking too much. All right. Of course, her black ass didn't listen to me, though, when I told her to get a smaller size drink. A few times in the past, I almost had to body slam her ass when she was around me and got drunk. Tanisha would let all kinds of disrespectful shit fly out of her mouth when she drank, and to avoid us having a fucked up night, I was trying to minimize her alcohol intake. Nah, I'm good. I got my own drink. I'm cool with my sour apple. Your shit got too much going on, I told her, as I looked at her cup and saw all the fruity flavors that she had going on. She laughed, took another sip of her drink, and went back to smoking the hookah as we waited for our food to come out. It was Sunday, and honestly, I had been in the crib chilling tonight. I had my son with me all day, and we ran the streets doing father and son shit. What father and son shit was y'all doing, my guy? He's in a wheelchair. I don't think y'all was doing that much, but okay. After doing all of that, we went to Sade's crib and we kicked it with her and Colony. Sade was over there putting my nephew to work. She had that nigga wash all her fucking cars and even made that man cut her grass, knowing she had a whole bunch of fucking yard for him to be cutting all that shit. I ain't gonna say she was wrong, though, because his little ass was tripping by bringing that damn gun to school. Back when I was his age, I know I used to do some dumbass shit, but I ain't never had a boss to take one of Kato's guns to school. Our pops was batshit crazy. He would have beat the shit out of us for doing some dumb shit like that. I talked to Colony, though, and he told me the same story that he told his pops and Sade about overhearing this dude talking about how he was going to shoot the school up. Man, the way I would have come home and told my people about that shit, his dumbass carrying on talking about he ain't want to be a fucking snitch. What the dumbest shit I ever heard. After chilling with Sade for a bit, I headed back to Nene's house to leave KJ with her. He had physical therapy first thing in the morning, and that was the only reason I took him back home. Honestly, since Nene and I fucked, her ass had been carrying on like the shit never happened. She was treating me like I treat these hoes when I get the pussy and they never hear from me again. I just knew that after we fucked, she would at least consider the idea of getting back into a relationship with me, but nah, she let me hit it one more time the morning after, and after that, we were back to regular co-parenting. I wanted to curse the fuck out of her because I felt like she used a nigga for some dick, and did, and act like you ain't do the same, stupid motherfucker. Like, what the hell? You got a lot of fucking nerve, good sir. Oh, y'all, I forgot to do something. Hold on. Hey, Angela Caldwell Boo, welcome. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. I remember thinking, I remember the last person that I saw come in was you, and then child got caught up in this damn book, and yeah. Hey, Kia. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. All right. I'm sorry it took me so long to address you, darling. Thank you for being here, though. I appreciate you. All right. The whole time I was fucking Nene, I could tell she was extremely backed up sexually, so after she let me dig up in all night, she quickly cut ties with a nigga. As much as I love Nene and as much as I'd be willing to get my family back, I wasn't gonna keep begging her ass for that shit and getting turned down. That's why my dumb ass kept going back to Tanisha, knowing that bitch was no good for me and our shit was toxic as fuck. All we did was argue and fight. I swear, I don't see how we even had the time to fuck because every time I was around her, it was some bullshit. She was the one that hit me this evening, telling me about the comedy show and asking me if I wanted to go. Because I ain't have shit going on, I agreed. I was working on staying my ass out of the strip club because it seemed like every time I went, some bullshit popped off. My phone went off and it was a text message coming through from Nene. I'd spoken her ass right on up. She'd sent me a video, and from the thumbnail, I could see that KJ was in the video. She had him in the living room. He was out of his wheelchair and propped up on the living room couch. The song Spin Bout You by Drake and 21 Savage was playing on a TV screen, and with a big smile on his face, he was bobbing his head to the music with his one finger in the air attempting to sing the song. I laughed because that was a song that I kept on repeat when I had it playing in my car. On some toxic shit, I'd be sending that song to Nene, basically letting her know that I shoot some shit up over her. To see my boy rocking out to it had me cracking up because he wasn't missing shit. He paid attention to everything I did. Along with the video, Nene sent a text message which read, "Chaotic, you see him. Nobody but you got my son listening to this song. I was about to put a movie on for us, and I noticed that he was humming the lyrics, so that's when I played the song for him. Look at his finger in the air." I cracked up reading Nene's message, and I had to have played this video over 5 more times. I swear I completely zoned out as I looked at my son because I was so in love with him that it didn't make any sense. "Stop hating. That's daddy's man right there. Let my twin vibe out." I sent my message and Nene sent back some laughing emojis. Prior to those messages, there was a thread from last week when I was asking her to let me come over and eat her pussy again. I was smoking weed that night and my dick was hard, so I was talking reckless in them text messages. I was unaware of the shit that was happening around me, and even with the privacy screen protector on my phone, Tanisha's ass still somehow saw it because she snatched the phone out of my hand. I tried to snatch that shit back from her, but her ass was fast, moving to an empty chair at our table. We were sitting at a square table that had 4 chairs, and she went for the empty one on the opposite side from where I was sitting. I reached over and tried to snatch that shit away from her again, but she stood up, and I saw her finger just scrolling, reading through my message thread between Nene and me. As she looked at the messages, she laughed while shaking her head. "And you used to swear up and down that a bitch was crazy when I would accuse you of wanting to fuck with your baby mama. Nigga, you just fucked this bitch 2 weeks ago from these fucking text messages, and you probably been fucking that bitch long before, too. You are one dirty ass nigga," she spat and threw the phone. That shit hit me right in my mouth. Whoops. Oh, well. "Bet you won't be eating no coochie this evening." The nigga in me wanted to reach over and choke the shit out of this bitch, but that would be some bitch shit. So I took that shit to the chin. I stood up, went in my pockets, grabbed a couple hundreds, tossed that shit on the table, and dipped. Motherfuckers were already looking at us, and I was sure they were ready to pull their phones out and record, thinking they were about to get a show. But I wasn't on that shit with Tanisha tonight. I done got into it too many times with her in public, embarrassing the fuck out of myself, so I refused to stoop low like that again tonight. "The bitch pussy can't be that good because why you still coming back and fucking me, Chaotic? Why you still taking me out on dates and shit if you still fucking with your baby mama? Your tongue done been all in my pussy and my ass. Then you go back and fuck that bitch. Ask her how my pussy tastes then," she snapped from behind me as we walked out of the restaurant. We'd been sitting outside, so it was nothing to just get up, and my car was right in the parking lot. Tanisha was drunk. I could hear that shit in the way she slurred her words. This was that bullshit I be talking about when I say that I hated for her to drink because her mouth would get reckless. "Hey, shut the fuck up before I leave your dumb ass out here and you gotta find your own way home. You talking too reckless, shorty. If Nene was standing right here, you wouldn't be popping off with none of this slick ass shit. So chill the fuck out. Stop acting like you ain't fucking other niggas too. Cody just hit me a couple days ago and told me he saw you in diamonds, chilling in another nigga's section, dancing and kissing all on that nigga. Chill the fuck out. We do the same shit." "Yeah, I was dancing and kissing all on that paid ass nigga. He got way more money than you too." That shit made a nigga start laughing for real because now she was just saying anything. "You don't even believe that, beautiful. You ain't ever in your life fucked with a nigga that got more money than me, so don't even put that kind of lie out there into the universe. If you was having your way, dancing and kissing all on that paid ass nigga, why the fuck you hit my line begging a nigga to take you out tonight? Fuck out of here with all that bullshit," I snapped as I pulled out the key for my Hellcat and unlocked the doors. "Fuck you, Chaotic. Fuck you. Yes, I fuck around with other niggas because your black ass don't want to commit. We've been fucking around with each other for a while now, and you still haven't put a title on what we're doing because you're too busy lusting over your fucking baby mama. You can have her because I can't do this shit anymore. Fuck you, that bitch, and that retarded ass fucking baby of y'all's," she snapped. Oh, no, in the fizzle, the fuck she didn't. Oh, you raggedy bitch. Child, let me wet my whistle because I think he about to rock bottom this fucking girl. Mm. Ooh. Lord have mercy. Well, all right, whistle's wet. The last part of her sentence had me rushing her. She tried to run, but I did that pussy shit that I swore I would never do. My hand wrapped around her neck, and I stood out there trying to kill that bitch with my bare hands. Ho, is you crazy? Say whatever the fuck you want to say about my baby mama and me. But leave my kid out of this shit. I'll fucking kill your ass right where the fuck you stand and do that time like a man for speaking on my fucking kid. Is you crazy, bitch? I gritted, making my grip a little tighter. I could see it in her eyes that she was scared out of her fucking mind of me and thought I was gonna kill her for real. Her long fingernails raked at my hand, trying to remove my grip. Just before the bitch could take her last breath, I let go of her, and she started aggressively coughing and dry heaving. Hey, man, whatever the fuck me and you was doing, consider that shit dead. You spoke on my fucking handicapped kid, and you probably been feeling that way about my little man, but you just now had the balls to say it. Call up one of your hoe-ass friends and tell one of them bitches to pick you up. I don't give a fuck how you get home. I snapped and left her dumb ass right there. As I started my car, I heard her yelling for me to stop and unlock the doors, but I backed up and got the fuck out of Dodge. The whole time I was in the car, my heart was aggressively beating because as I choked her, I could feel how out of my body I was and how I was just seconds away from ending that bitch's life. My black ass would have been serving a lifetime prison sentence. My son ain't deserved that, and my baby mama didn't deserve to have to raise KJ on her own either, so I was glad I ain't really lose it and kill that bitch. I swear, I was done fucking around with Tanisha for good. That toxic shit wasn't it. I ain't gonna even say that I was wrong for fucking Nene on Tanisha because Tanisha wasn't my bitch. I fucked her, and I fucked other hoes too, just as she fucked other niggas. If she and I had been in a committed relationship, then I would have taken full ownership of cheating. The only thing I felt like I was wrong about was bringing her ass around my fucking family and the couple of times I had her around KJ. I was never supposed to do that shit because that was probably why the bitch thought we were a couple. I was about to start chilling. In this line of business, we already went through enough shit, and the last thing I was trying to add to my plate was me out there beefing with bitches. I was gonna leave these hoes alone for a while because this shit was becoming too fucking toxic. All I wanted was for a bitch to be my fucking peace, but that seemed to be fucking impossible these days. And that's the end of that chapter. Ooh, child. Listen, y'all. I'm mad that she, you know, that's how that girl been feeling. That's why I say it don't matter how long you be with somebody. If they feel a way about your kid, yeah. No God. Single mothers and single fathers, be careful. Motherfuckers is out here fucking kids up on bullshit. That's a damn shame, too. She called that baby retarded. Dirty ass cocko. All right, let me get this next time stamp, child. Musty bitch. Don't make no damn sense. She said, is that smoke coming from the grill or what? It's smelling kind of loud. Oh, my God, child. Listen, you know, I don't know. I just feel like you gotta, when it comes to dating people and you got kids, man, yeah, it'd be on the news every other week. Some goof troop ass bitch done left some new nigga that she fucking around her child and he done beat the baby to death or some shit like that, or, you know, doing something to the child. Like, come on, fam. We gotta do better. Be careful. Vet these motherfuckers. But nah. Motherfuckers is like Risa Tisa. I don't want to be alone and I'm ready to get married. So you just gonna marry any old raggedy lollipop sucker tussie roll motherfucker that come your way? So just fuck the kids, huh? Just fuck your spirit and fuck your peace, right? You just want a dick in the bed with you. Just any old raggedy ass Nestle Crunch face ass nigga do, huh? Oh, okay. I duly noted. I got you. I'm just saying, you could have told a bitch what it was, though. Like, that's crazy. And then to come out here and try to act like you was done wrong. Girl, you signed up for that bullshit. You thought it was going to be like a gym membership. No, God. Your ass thought you was slick and fucked around and got. That's what you thought. You fucked around and then you found out. Shit. Chapter 7, Pleasure Strong. You look fucked out. Nene was the one to call me out on the FaceTime group call that I was on with her and the rest of our girls. This was day 4 in Fiji, and it was so fucking beautiful out there that if I could have it my way, I would never go back to Miami. My ass had been living La Vida Loca, pregnancy edition, drinking as many non-alcoholic drinks as I pleased, enjoying beautiful views, getting my back broken in a few times a day, my man spoiling me, massaging me, complimenting me with each new piece of clothing that I put on, and just loving me. We flew private to Fiji and stayed in this nice-ass water bungalow. It was the Liku Liku. That's the name of it. Liku Liku. Child, that shit is hard to say, and especially if you've been drinking, but which I haven't, just coffee. But I'm just saying, like, once you get drunk and you go out somewhere and the driver asks you where you staying, child, try saying Liku Liku when your ass been getting liquored. You ain't gonna be able to do it, right? As soon as you start stumbling over your shit, they be like, okay, I know where you going. So they were at the Liku Liku Lagoon Resort, and this was easily one of the most beautiful resorts that Corporate and I have ever stayed in. It low-key reminded me of our bungalow that we stayed in for a week in Bora Bora for our honeymoon. The island was so beautiful, peaceful, and relaxing. The dinners we had were so romantic as well. Corporate was booking private dinners for us in a beautiful ambiance with music playing in the background mixed with the sounds of the ocean. Our first night, we stayed in one of the regular bungalows because the underwater one that Corporate wanted wasn't available until the next day. So on day 2, we switched rooms for the underwater bungalow, which gave us complete privacy, and it was luxurious as hell. In our bedroom, we could literally see the ocean surrounding us out of our windows. It was so breathtaking. Girl, I am, was all I could say as I lay on the couch wearing nothing but my towel because I'd just gotten out of the shower not too long ago. Okay. Corporate and I were getting ready to go to dinner. We were up early this morning for breakfast, and then we did some water activities. After that, we went on a few tours and came back to the room and slept for about 5 hours. Now it was time for dinner, and I was just lying there relaxing while Corporate showered. Once I was done, I'd get up to do my hair and makeup in the bathroom. You look it, and I should kill you for already messing up that nice-ass silk press that I gave you the other day, Kanye said. They were 8 hours behind us on time, so while it was going on 9 at night here, it was about 1 in the afternoon their time. Everyone on the phone had their own thing going on. I could see that Kanye was at work with his AirPods in, and he had his phone propped up. Rika was at her dance studio because I knew she had a class to teach at 2 o'clock. Nene was sitting in her cop car. Sanai was in the damn bed. Corey was at the damn mall, and Asia was in her office. I told you I wanted braids, but you told me no, I reminded him, taking my eyes off the camera for a second so I could peek over at my man, who was now out of the bathroom. He had a towel wrapped around his waist, and I could see the beads of water on his chest, stomach, arms, and some were on his legs. The man was too damn fine. Those waves in his hair were breathtaking, and the beard was nice and wet, too, from him washing his face. And from where he stood, I could smell him. Corporate didn't even have to be doing anything for his dick print to show. It was visible as hell, even with the thick white towel wrapped around his waist. Ooh, Lord. Ooh, child, I'm over here coughing and shit. Anyway, he caught me looking at him, and he licked his lips. Those same lips that had been kissing all over me, licking me, biting me, all things that had been driving me crazy over the past few days that we'd been there. I stopped looking at him because all it would take was a second for me to get hot, hang the phone up, and we would be back to fucking again. Truth be told, Juicy needed a damn break. Sister girl was out there wilding. Because I know you, Pleasure, you'll take them braids out in 2 days. That's why I didn't put no braids in your hair. P, you need to get your ass on social media. You've been sending us pictures and videos, eating us up with the looks you've been serving. I keep posting you on my story, and everybody is responding, asking me for your Instagram page, Kanye said, and I laughed. I never had social media. Even back when I was dancing, I didn't have anything because that had just never been my thing. I knew in real life that I was an it girl, and social media tended to be so fucking judgy. So that just wasn't something I found an interest in. Corporate's ass didn't have social media either, but from the way he took pictures and videos of me, you would think he was taking them to post somewhere, but nope, they were stored right in his phone in the album he had for me. Don't be trying to recruit my wife to get no social media, nigga. We like shit the way it is. Staying out of the fucking way and living in our own little world. The second she posts a picture, them niggas gonna be in her inbox, and now I gotta kill them, Corporate said, hearing his cousin Kanye on the phone. He had the women laughing as he walked over and stood in front of me. I kept the camera on my face as he looked at me. There was a whole other conversation going on over the phone now between Nene and Koi, so no one was paying me any attention as I lay there lusting over my man. Mute the phone right quick, Corporate said. He leaned his head in and moved the phone, taking the camera off my face. Corporate put his head right in front of mine and kissed me on my lips. As we kissed, his hand cuffed my pussy and I jumped at his touch. He was so slick with the way he did it. "Your pussy still sore?" he asked me in that soft, deep bedroom voice that I loved. Pause. Let me tell y'all why y'all laughing. Y'all remember that book I was reading that time? I forget what book it was. And the dude asked his wife, "My pussy still sore?" And she said, "I don't know, touch it and see since you got one, nigga." Oh my God. Listen, the way I hollered. Oh my God. I think I laughed for about 5 minutes at that shit. Oh, Lord. All right. So anyway, I've been telling this man since we've been here how sore my pussy was from dealing with him, but it wasn't too much of a damn problem because I was still having sex. We can still hear y'all. Sanai's voice came through the phone. I moved the phone so fast from my face that I'd forgotten to mute it like Corporate told me to. I laughed to play it off, pissed that they'd heard him, and then I put the camera back on me. Anytime a man gotta ask if your pussy is still sore, that means it's too much fucking going on over there. Corporate, ease up on my girl. She's pregnant, Nene said. Nene, that shit don't even be me. Pleasure be tripping, horny like she off fucking perks. He talked shit to them, making them laugh. I playfully kicked him and told him to go so I could finish talking to my girls. All right. He left to get ready for dinner, and I stayed on the phone with them for about 15 more minutes before I told them that I'd call them back tomorrow. They all told me to make sure I sent them pictures of me tonight, and I promised them that I would. After wrapping up my conversation with my girls, I called Big Mom just to check in with her and make sure she was okay. She was with Rhodesia, which was something I really didn't want because I knew Rhodesia would give Big Ma the unhealthy stuff that she likes to eat while I wouldn't. Big Ma assured me that she was fine, and she told me that she was watching old episodes of Judge Mathis. That lady loved her some Judge Mathis. She'd probably seen every damn episode that was out. Once we wrapped up our conversation, I stood, stretched, and went into the bathroom so I could beat this face. I changed out of my towel to do that, and I put on the black silk robe that I'd packed with me. I was going for a natural face tonight, which was one of my favorite looks to do on myself. While I was beating my face, I kept the bathroom door open because Corporate was talking to me about the phone conversation that he'd had earlier with Sade regarding Colony. He was expelled from school, so they had to find a new school for him. Sade had been sending different schools to Corporate, but that wasn't even the biggest issue. The biggest problem was when he went before a judge next month. I feared that they'd try to give him some time since this wasn't his first offense. I knew Alicia was a bomb-ass attorney, so I just prayed she'd be able to work her magic and Colony would only have to do community service or something. We'd gone swimming earlier, and when we got back, I washed and blow-dried my hair, so now I had to do something with it. I had very thick-ass hair, even with the shoulder-length feathered bob that my hair was always in. I knew how to do my own silk presses, but the thing is, I just hated having to do them. That shit be killing my arms, especially when I had to flat iron the back of my hair and the middle. I got my hair bone straight, but I wanted to rock a different look tonight. I was able to brush it back into a low ponytail, keeping it in a knot. And I gave myself baby hairs on the back of my neck and on the perimeter of my forehead. I looked so pretty, and I already knew that once I put on this daring outfit that I was wearing tonight, I'd look even better. I stepped out of the bathroom, and my husband was already dressed. He was sitting at the foot of the bed, dressed in all black. The first four buttons were undone on his short-sleeved silk top, so his nice, well-defined chest was on display. He wore black slacks on the top, with the top, and even sitting down, I could see that the slacks had the perfect fit. They weren't too tight, but they weren't too loose either. A clean pair of black Christian Louboutin dress shoes were on his feet, and he wore light jewelry, just a plain Jane Audemars Piguet on his left wrist, along with his wedding band and a small Cuban link chain around his neck. He smelled so good, too, as he glared over at me. "Your hair looks pretty, baby. Your makeup, too," he complimented me. I was the kind of woman who was complimented on a daily whenever I went out in public. Whether people liked my outfit, shoes, bag, or choice of scent, didn't matter. I was gonna get complimented. But I swear it was something totally different when my man complimented me. Every compliment felt like it was the first one he'd ever given me, and I love that shit. "Thank you, Daddy. You look good," I told him. "Shit, I got to. Look how fine my wife is. I gotta come with it," he casually said. I laughed and applied lotion and oil all over my skin after coming out of my robe. Corporate had the TV on, giving it his full attention and allowing me to get dressed in peace. I chose to wear a nice white bralette piece, but it was strapless, and the girls were sitting up so pretty in that top. I paired it with a sheer metallic gold long skirt, so the black high-waisted panties that I wore underneath were visible. Listen, the outfit was daring as hell, but I love sexy shit like this, and I had a man who was secure as hell, so when I was with him, he ain't trip about me wearing those kinds of clothes. Now, if I was going out with the girls, he might have told my ass to change. I put on a nice gold choker. Child, they put chocker. I'm dead. Choker, necklace, and my Tiffany studs. The outfit spoke for itself, so I didn't have to do too much with the jewelry. My wedding ring stood out, and I put on a couple of gold tennis bracelets along with it. Looking at myself in the mirror that was attached to the dresser, everything came out perfect. The gold highlighter that I'd put on my face really had the outfit popping. I grabbed my metallic gold heels from the bed and effortlessly put them on. As I did that, I could feel Corporate's eyes on me, and it felt like he was staring into my soul. When I turned to look at him, he playfully stuck his tongue out and started panting like a dog. "Man, I did right by putting them two kids in you. Niggas ain't got a wife and a baby mama as fine as I do. I got a lot of shit that the average nigga can't say they have. Look at you, P. God ain't play fair toward everyone else. He gave you everything. Body, titties, ass, lips, and the face needs to be hung up in a fucking museum. The pussy gets disrespectfully wet. Dope-ass personality. Your voice is pretty as fuck. And you're smart. Need I keep fucking going?" he asked. Standing up from the bed, he walked over to me and cuffed my ass with his large hands. My damn cheeks were on fire from how much this man had me smiling from the way he was gassing me. I put my hands around his neck and looked into his beautiful light brown eyes. "You can keep going," I replied with a smile on my face, wanting to hear him boast about me some more. He was the reason my ass was so cocky and full of myself now, because of the beautiful shit he would say to me. "You got some pretty ass light brown eyes, prettiest fucking toes that I've ever seen before on a woman. That's why I can't keep them shits out of my mouth. You don't have no corns or nothing, baby." "Yep," he said, and that had me cracking up laughing because my husband was saying those things to me, and he was dead-ass serious. I was wearing makeup, and he knew not to kiss me on my lips because I'd done a combination of lip gloss and lipstick that I didn't want to mess up, so he just leaned in and kissed me on my neck. After one last rub on my behind, he let me go. Before we walked out the door, I sprayed a couple dabs of my Maison Francois Girl Kirk de... baby. Nah, we ain't doing that. She sprayed some MFK, which was one of my favorite scents at the moment. Then I grabbed the metallic gold clutch that I had resting on the bed, which just housed my phone and some feminine items that I like to have on me. Listen, I ain't got enough money to know nothing about them fancy ass fucking colognes and perfumes. I wear regular bitch shit, right? Like, what the fuck? I bet you I got some fucking essential oils that'll give all that fancy, smancy, expensive-ass fucking eau de parfum-ass bullshit some a run for they fucking money. And it'll last all fucking day. Right. Shit. My wallet was somewhere packed in my duffel bag because I was with Daddy and I need money of my own whenever I was with him. Corporate and I made it outside our bungalow and we walked the wooden ground where he held my hand, leading the way to our private dinner. My stomach was loudly erupting because I hadn't eaten anything since we'd had lunch, and that was hours ago, way before the nap that we'd taken. One second, yeah. All right, sorry, y'all. I definitely planned to pig out on whatever food was on the menu tonight. We eventually made it over to our own private tiki hut, and there were these big mosaic letters that spelled out love. I gushed upon seeing that, along with a private table that was set for two. There were rose petals along with nice plateware and silverware on the table waiting for us. Off to the side, there were about four men with a nice little fire show going on. Being with my husband and doing romantic things like that had me in my feelings big time because I was reminded of the past. Corporate used to do stuff like this all the time when he and I first got together. I remember Mercy used to be pissed with me because Corporate would have me flying out to different countries with him, and he would have me gone for weeks at a time. He wouldn't give a bitch any notice either. Mercy didn't like it because I was costing him money since it was my face alone that was bringing in a lot of the party goers. By the time I stopped dancing, Corporate would literally come home, tell me to get ready, and he would surprise me with a trip. God, I was so in love with him at that time. I still was in love with my husband, but in the earlier years, when we first got together, the feeling of being in love was that much more special because it was so new. I remember always telling Corporate that it felt like I couldn't breathe when he wasn't around me, and he would tell me that I was high off dick and that my ass was in love. Years later, it was still those same feelings, even though our shit could get a little rocky at times. "I know your hard body ass is not about to start crying," Corporate said, once we made it to the table. I laughed through a single tear that had already fallen from my face, and I playfully hit him in his chest. "This is just taking me back to the very beginning, that's all," I told him, as I picked up a cloth from the table to dab at my eyes, which were hella misty. I spent all that time in the bathroom making sure I had the perfect beat for my face, only for me to come out there and start crying on the verge of messing it up. Corporate came and stood behind me, wrapping his large arms around me and placing his hands on my stomach. "All right, sorry." He leaned in, causing his long, thick beard to tickle me. "Bae, I promise shit is gonna get back to how it used to be. You're my wife, so you know I pay attention to every little detail. Being with you these past few days, I swear I can't remember the last time I had you smiling like this. That made me realize that I gotta step up my game as a husband. I can't just be fucking you good and let that be that. It's other shit that I gotta work on to make you happy. You called me out on my shit the other day, telling me how I haven't been taking you out on dates, and I needed to hear that shit. Lately, I've been treating our shit more so like a business relationship, and I've forgotten about the romance. Somehow along the way, I lost track of the little shit you like, such as coming home with your favorite cookies and rubbing your feet until you fall asleep. Shit like waking you up in the middle of the night and handing you your scarf to put on if you got too tired and forgot to wrap your hair, because I know how serious you take your silk presses. A nigga got some shit to work on, but all I ask is that you don't give up on me," Corporate said into my ear. To hear such a strong, manly man be so vulnerable and acknowledge his fuck-ups, I swear he had me in my damn feelings big time. I talked all that shit to him earlier today before I laid down for my nap, and I swore that I wouldn't give up any more pussy for the rest of the trip, but as soon as we made it back to that room, it would be on and popping. At that point, I said, damn the makeup, as I turned my head around while he was still holding me from behind. My hand cuffed the sides of his face and we started tongue kissing. The music, the candles that were lit, and this beautiful beach all enhanced the romantic setting between us. I eventually pulled away from him and he stepped back to pull my chair out. I took a seat and then he went around the table and took a seat down as well. I could tell that our waiter was giving us our moment because as soon as we were in our chairs, he came over, introducing himself, poured our glasses of water, and asked us what we wanted to drink. I was so used to ordering a shot and a cocktail when I went out, but now that I was baking up two babies inside me, it had just been water and lemonade. My man ordered his shot of Henny, and I did a happy dance because that Henny dick was dick like none other. Child, listen. You don't know what you want, baby. At times, you not fucking with the Henny dick. Then other times, you damn near try to shut a Henny down my throat. Which one is it? He asked, sitting across from me with his arms crossed and damn near undressing me with his eyes as he waited for my answer. Corporate and I were overly attracted to each other. You could just look at us and see the way we lusted after each other. Corporate, sometimes your ass like to have Henny dick on a damn Tuesday and a bitch be tired, so it just depends on my mood, I told him, and he smirked. All right then, what's your mood tonight? If you ain't fucking with Henny dick, let me know and I'll tell brother bring me back a Sprite or some shit, he said, and I giggled. No, get a couple shots of Henny. I'm well rested. I'm feeling like I can keep up tonight, I let him know, and he rubbed his hands together, loving the sound of that. Oh. Wait a fucking minute, yo. Sorry, y'all. All right. It wasn't long before the waiter came back over with my lemonade and Corporate's shot, which he quickly guzzled down, and then we ordered our food. I went with the surf and turf, and for my sides, I added vegetables with mashed potatoes. My man had a grown man appetite, so he went in, ordering the porterhouse steak with the giant tiger shrimp, and he did a loaded baked potato and vegetables as well. Shit, y'all gonna be too fucking full to fuck. Good googly moogly, child. You get too full, y'all ain't gonna have shit but the itis, hell. Y'all know what I'm talking about. All right. Once our orders were in, Corporate pulled his phone out and told me that he wanted to snap some pictures of me. He gassed me up with each photo that he took of me, and then I took some of him. The waiter had come over and snapped some of us together. After that, while we waited for our food, we danced in the sand to the soft music that was playing out there. The night was so beautiful. My husband had the ability to have me cracking up to the point that I had tears falling from my eyes, and I was clutching my stomach hard from it getting cramped. That's just how tickled he had me with some of the stuff he said. The food was amazing, along with the dessert that I was somehow able to make room for. We danced and just enjoyed this peaceful moment between us. After dinner, he lifted me in his arms and carried me bridal style back up to our bungalow as I held my heels in my hands because my feet were killing me. He carried me all the way to our room, and once we got inside, he put me down. I wanted to keep the romantic mood going, so I walked over to the sliding glass door in our room, which led to our very own private balcony that housed a mini swimming pool. If I took the steps down, I could see and get in the ocean. I only had use for the pool at that time, though, so I kept the glass door open and started the jets up in the pool. Then I pulled out my phone, went to my girl Summer Walker's radio station on Pandora, and let the music play. While the phone was in my hands, I went ahead to the group chat and sent my girls the pictures that my man had taken of me tonight before I rested my phone on one of the lounge chairs. Finally, I walked back into the room, and as I walked in, my man was walking out holding his cigar. With his free hand, he slapped me on my ass. I took my happy ass into the bathroom, where I took one of my makeup wipes and removed the makeup from my face. The shit I was about to be out there doing, I needed to do it with a bare face. Ooh, child. All right, honey, let me find out. All right. Once all the makeup was off, I did a quick skin routine, and then I went back into the bedroom. I stripped out of my clothes, went into my luggage, and pulled out a plain black bikini. The bottoms were a thong to show off how perfectly my ass sat up. I like to get my tops a size too small so my breasts could hang out at the bottom, and that's exactly what was going on here. My sandals that were on the floor, I slipped my feet inside them and made my way outside to join corporate. He had his legs casually chilling in the pool as he smoked a cigar that was in his hands. My man was so hood, sitting there bobbing his head to some old school Alicia Keys the way he was vibing. You would have thought some Jeezy was playing since that was his favorite artist. Take your clothes off. Put on your swimming trunks and get in the water with me, I invited, slipping my feet out of the slides and dipping my right foot into the water to test it. It was nice and warm, just how I liked it, and bubbling up, ready for me to get inside. I'ma watch you swim, he responded, right before he put the cigar to his lips and blew some smoke out. I stepped into the water, and once it came all the way up to my neck, I walked over and stared up at him. Baby, take your clothes off. Just sit right here on the edge, I urged again. This time he stood and quickly came out of his slacks and silk shirt. Now he was in just his Calvin Klein briefs, and that big dick was right there, looking like a third leg. I admired Corporate's body just as I did any other time I saw him without any clothes on. In just his briefs, he took a seat at the edge of the pool and kept his legs open so I could stand in the middle of them. I propped my arms on his lap, getting his thighs wet. You happy? He questioned. I giggled and nodded, letting him know that I was extremely happy. His hand that wasn't holding the cigar he used to reach behind me and untie my bikini top. I knew he would do that because he kept eyeing my breasts, and I knew that it was only a matter of time before he wanted to see my titties. He got it off and tossed it on the side of him. With my arms still propped on his thighs, I bent my head and let soft, sensual kisses on each of his abs. And then I turned around in his arms, giving him my back, but continuing to stand in the middle of his legs. Something about your hands on my body, Corporate's deep voice crooned from behind me as I See You by Coco Jones played. I laughed as I turned my head to look at him. Baby, what you know about this song? I questioned. You play this shit all fucking day every day. Shit would be weird if I didn't know this motherfucker. Bae, no lie. A few nights ago, when I was headed back to the crib, I had this playing in the car. Coco was talking that shit. I fuck with this song. I think of you every time I hear this shit. I better be who you think about when this plays, I shot, only for him to put pressure on my nipple as he squeezed it. I could see him behind me from the corner of my eye as he put the cigar out, and then with his strong ass arms, he lifted me right onto his lap where I felt how hard his dick was through his briefs. He quickly untied the strings on the sides of my bikini, and in seconds, he had my bottoms off, and I sat before him fully naked. My legs were bent, propped up on his muscular thighs, and he had his left arm around my waist, keeping me secure in the spot with my back facing him. His head leaned into the crook of my neck, tickling me with his beard, and his right hand came in front of me, where he stuck two of his fingers into my mouth. I sucked on them like they were his dick. Then he pulled them out and dragged those same two fingers down my flat stomach and brushed them against my clit. In seconds, he was pushing those two fingers inside me, having me jump at his touch like I was a virgin all over again, and all this shit was new to me. Corporate was the kind of nigga who just knew how to please a woman's body. He ain't need a manual. He didn't need to be told. None of that shit. He just knew how to please a woman, and that's why I couldn't seem to get enough of his ass. He started slowly finger fucking me and using his thumb to rub against my clit in a circular motion. Shit, I moaned and dropped my head all the way back until it rested on his chest, loving the shit he was doing to me. I already knew Corporate was only doing this to get a bitch warmed up. We'd been fucking like crazy for 4 days straight, and truthfully, my pussy needed a break, so I knew this was just the appetizer that his ass was giving me before the real thing. Damn, this shit's so wet. P, I feel like I'm dipping my fingers into some fucking water. Corporate spoke into my ear and kissed it. Then he started sucking on my neck, knowing damn well that was one of my many spots. He finger fucked me even faster, rubbing his thumb against my clit faster as well. My body involuntarily froze in his lap. No sound could escape to let him know I was about to come, so it came without warning when I started squirting. I snapped my legs shut against his fingers, unable to take that finger action anymore, and I started panting like I'd just run a race. those same fingers that he just slipped out of me. I could hear him behind me licking them clean. He eventually lifted me with just one arm, got his dick out through his briefs, and sat me down on all those inches. I whined and moaned my whole way down. "Show out, P. That's your dick. Get nasty with it." My husband coached me from behind as he held me by my ankles, allowing me to put the ball in my court and control the sex. Something about being reassured that this dick belonged to me while we were fucking just got me wetter. My hands were planted on his thighs, and I really got my ride on. I was grinding all on that dick, similar to how I did whenever I gave him a lap dance. I would bounce one ass cheek, then the next, and then do them both at the same time while still managing to give him pleasure by bouncing up and down on the dick. "What my pussy feel like, Corporate?" I taunted him as I turned my head to look at him over my shoulder. He was doing that sexy face that I loved where he bit his lip and it was obvious how turned on I had him. "Water, baby. This motherfucker feels like water. Do that shit, baby," he urged. My nails started digging into his thighs and my moans grew louder. My head fell back and I released orgasm number two. The second I got that shit out of my system, Corporate stood with me in his arms and walked me over to a lounge chair. We were both fully naked at that point. He put me down, and I knew he wanted me on all fours without him even having to tell me, so that's exactly what I did. I kept my ass tooted in the air while the upper part of my body was on the chair. I spread my arms all the way out, waiting to feel that dick plunge inside me. When he placed kisses all over my pussy first, I already knew he was forewarning me again about the wild ride he was about to take me on. Corporate was a huge sucker for doggy style, and this was usually the position where I started questioning if this man was even human because he would show off too much in that position. "We ain't doing that running shit tonight. You know how I need you when we fuck this way. Keep your ass tooted. Fuck back. And don't put your hands back here trying to push a nigga out. We can do that?" he asked. But he was already sliding inside me, never even giving a bitch a second to answer him. I was already moaning as I started slamming my ass into his pelvis. My eyes rolled because this shit felt so fucking good, but there was a twinge of pain that came from each stroke he gave me when he went in deep. "Corporate, I feel you in my stomach," I cried, telling him the God honest truth. "Then that means I'm right where I'm supposed to be. I love you, baby," he assured me. "I love you too, God," I screamed, feeling him going deeper. I was about to reach back and place my hand on his chest to ease him out some, but I remembered what he just told me not to do, so I didn't. Corporate slowed the strokes down a bit and his right hand started rubbing my ass. He pulled the dick out for a second and I was about to fuss about that, but I felt him put a thumb in me that he coated with my juices and he quickly put the dick back in. That same thumb that he'd just taken out of me, he went for my ass with it and attempted to slip it in, but I bucked at his touch. "Easy, baby. Chill. I got it," he coached. He went so slow as he stuck his thumb in my ass and then he was back fucking me deep and slow. A bitch was crying because that shit felt so fucking good. I was speaking in tongues. I swear to God, I didn't know what the fuck I was saying. "I love my fuck God." I couldn't even get a proper sentence out. This man was fucking with my damn mental the way he was fucking me. And it didn't take long for me to release again. My ass damn near ran from him once I started coming. Panting, I went for the head of the lounge chair. My husband looked at me with a smirk on his face and a glistening dick that was still standing and hadn't busted his nut yet. Granted, this nigga had been fucking me crazy like this for years, but I still looked at him like I was shocked behind the dick that I'd just gotten. My ass was through, though. I could feel myself about to tap out. "Baby, I can't go no more. You going to fucking kill me," I panted. "P, I thought this dick was worth dying for," his crazy ass said. "Corporate, baby, I'm weak," I pleaded, and he came over and picked me up, holding me in his strong arms. "Where you're weak, I'm strong. Come on, let a nigga get right," he begged, walking with me over to the wall and pinning me against it while he continued to hold on to me. The fucking started right back up. From the moment he pinned me against the wall, we must have fucked for 30 minutes straight. In the words of Nene, my ass was definitely fucked out. You could stick a fork in me for the rest of the night along with the rest of the trip. And that's the end of that chapter. Listen, Linda. Okay, y'all. I think I'm going to stop right here. Yeah. Because what chapter did we just finish? Oh, damn it. Hold on, y'all. Okay, so we just finished up 7. All right. Hold on, y'all. How much? All right, y'all. Buns, talking about the party just started. Yeah, well, y'all can stay in the backyard, child. Not them bounce house babies finna have fun, have good legs when they come out. You so fucking stupid. Buck your ass crazy, yo. Right. She talking about just starting for real. We got drinks flowing and games going. Well, y'all can continue to do that, child. That ain't got shit to do with me. No God. All right, I'm gonna give y'all asses one more chapter, but then I'm the fuck out now. Let me get this timestamp. Hold on. What is wrong with this fucking? Oh, Lord have mercy. Okay. All right, I got my time stamp. Not victory is ours. Buns, your ass is crazy. Oh, look. Not even church lady got a leg outside shaking. Oh, she's standing by the patio door with her leg out, shaking her leg. Y'all don't be trying to get church lady in no more trouble. She done told y'all, leave her the fuck alone. She said, go on now. She done already told y'all. Lord. Y'all so silly. All right. Yeah, but this it, y'all, because I got to get over there and watch BMF with the folks over there, child. And if you don't watched it already, you better not say nothing. Don't tell me that shit. Mm-mm. Okay. Here we go. 2 seconds. Chapter 8, Kyle Strong. This bitch ass nigga. Is this really necessary, nigga? I'm your brother and you patting a nigga down like I'm a fucking stranger in here. You tripping. My younger brother, Keanu, spat to me as I had him standing outside of my new apartment, just making sure this nigga wasn't coming inside this bitch with a phone or any weapons. These days, my trust was so fucked up, and I ain't know who was genuinely rocking with me and who wasn't. I felt like my son, Kyrie, was the only one I could trust these days, and even with that, I was still a little hesitant about how far I could let my trust go with him. Oh, this nigga over there, paranoid. Oh, he paranoid, y'all. That's what happened when you a snake-ass bastard stealing money from the plug, fuck nigga. Mm-mm. That's good for his ass. I can't wait to corporate just being this nigga. Anyway, I told Kyrie some deep secrets, letting him know how I'd stolen product from the company and had given that shit to old niggas who used to work for the company. And I even told him about me and Sade fucking. Oh, my God. Why would you do that, sir? I prayed that nigga didn't cross me because even though he was my son, I'd hate to have to take his ass out for teaming up with them niggas and switching up on me. It is necessary, homie. I gotta make sure that you're not coming down here on some snake shit, says the snake to everybody. Keanu was the cool brother who didn't like to be in the middle of all the fucking drama. All bro cared about was making his money and living a calm lifestyle. He was the kind of man who just wanted shit to be peaceful, and I knew that was why he didn't go so hard like I did when Cato died and didn't leave the organization to either of us. The nigga just went with the flow and he treated it like he was just thankful to have a seat at the table because he is, as he should be, stupid fucker. I hated that about Keanu because I felt like that shit made him look fucking soft. I wanted him to have the same energy towards certain shit as I did, but I was beginning to feel like maybe that would never happen. Hey, man, we've been talking on the phone and I told you the shit that I was on with you. You're my fucking brother, the only brother that I got left. So you don't got to worry about me coming down here to put a hole in your ass. I just came to this motherfucker to talk to you and see what the fuck is going on. You gonna let a nigga in or what? I sighed and then stepped back a bit so he could walk into my small one-bedroom apartment. I ain't gonna say that I was hiding, but that shit would have been foolish as fuck of me to still be living at my old apartment because that was the first place Corporate would have looked for me. In the past, I always felt like Corporate would never pull that trigger and take me out because he knew deep down that wasn't something his father, his grandfather, or his great-grandfather would ever approve of, so he kept me alive, but shit. Now that the nigga was aware of the shit that I'd done, there was no doubt in my mind that the nigga would pop me whenever he caught me. Yes, and I can't wait, you bastard. You look like shit, and this apartment looked like shit too, Keanu said, once he was fully inside and able to evaluate me and my living conditions. It was crazy because I was the kind of dude who liked to sit in the barber's chair at least once a week to get myself a nice lineup. I ain't play that shit when it came to my appearance. I had been that way since I was a teenager. These days, I was under so much fucking stress that I can't even tell you the last time I sat in a barber's chair. I had a 5 o'clock shadow going on, which was crazy because I like to keep a clean face. My hair had grown out longer than usual, and a nigga just looked dusty. Anyone could look around this small living room and see all of what I had eaten this week. There was the wrapper from my burger that I had a few days ago from McDonald's, spelled M-A-C, Donald's. Mac, not Mick, Mac. Oh, they are black, though. So anyway, then there was the empty pizza box from last night. The containers that housed my hot wings and the other bullshit that I'd eaten were strewn around. There were empty beer bottles lying around, too, and on the couch were all kinds of crumbs and shit, so I ain't even blame Keanu for not wanting to take a seat. And I don't think it's the crumbs, sir. It's the roaches that might be crawling through that motherfucker. Ain't nobody trying to take none of your dusty-ass super friends back to their crib. The fuck? I was the one to sit on the couch while he stood next to me and ran his hand over his head. Now, how you gonna invite you to his crib and shit and then send you home with a fucked up parting gift? Yeah, a roach in your fucking pocket. Nigga, bye. You gotta help me understand you, Kyle. We a family, and shit is not supposed to be like this right now. You beefing with Corporate and the rest of his brothers, so you gotta make this shit make sense to me. Why did you feel the need to steal bricks? My nigga, you was eating good. I know you ain't have the spot in the business that you wanted, but your pockets wasn't affected by that shit. You push nice cars, you could afford to go anywhere in the fucking world. You had a nice high-rise apartment, and even if you felt like the money you was making wasn't good enough, you could have done like Corporate and expanded into a fucking business or something. You gotta make this shit right, man, because I really believe in my heart that Corporate is gonna kill you. I know you can't give the fucking bricks back, but at least pay the nigga back his fucking money. I sucked my teeth while I shook my head because he was talking a bunch of bullshit. I angrily looked at him, just thinking to myself that there was no way in hell he was related to us. Kato and I couldn't possibly be his blood brothers. Do you fucking hear yourself, nigga? When you open your mouth to speak, do you hear yourself? You talking about you know I wasn't where I wanted to be in the business, but at least I was making good money. You probably say that shit like you cool with the idea of fucking settling. Motherfucker, Kato was our brother. He was supposed to pass this shit down to us, but he fucking didn't, nigga. You mad at the wrong people. When we go to wherever the fuck we go after this life, take that shit up with Kato then and find out from him why he ain't handing this shit down to you or me. I can't dwell on some shit that I can't fucking change, man, and it kills me that after all these damn years, you still mad about that. I told you before that when Kato was killed, I learned that he was passing the business down to his wife in Corporate. I felt some kind of way about that shit too, but nigga, I got over it. I allowed Sade and Corporate to have a clean slate, and I watched the way they run this business. They do this shit damn good. The two of them are not fucking sloppy like how your ass is. Best believe if you was in charge and we was beefing with those BB niggas the way we are now, we would have lost so many fucking men who work with us because you would have been so fucking trigger happy, ready to pull up inside the wrong kind of territory with no proper plan. Your dumb ass don't think. And when you don't think, you harm all kinds of motherfuckers around you. Corporate told me how he had to put Petey and them niggas down. You know that shit was sloppy on your part. Them young niggas lost their lives because you promised them a lifestyle that they had when they was working for the strong business. Corporate is beefing with Kyrie. So what? You gonna get your son killed in the process of this shit too? Keanu asked. I shot him a nasty glare once he brought up Kyrie. I played a lot of games, but all bets were off when it came to my son. After he finished his rant, it was silent for a good 3 to 4 minutes. I was the one to sigh and break the awkward silence as I looked up at him, prepared to say what I had to say. At the end of the day, man, I ain't going to corporate and apologizing for shit I did, because if the opportunity was given to me again, I'd do the same shit. I just wouldn't have been as fucking sloppy. The only thing I regret doing from all of this was having them niggas post up at the same spot as corporate had his men. I only had them stand out there because the spot I usually would have them was too hot that night. Them niggas lost their lives because of me. I know I can come off as a heartless nigga sometimes, but I don't like the way Pete and them had to die like that. They were just some young niggas who was trying to hustle and make some money. This some bullshit, man. What happened between you and Sade? Corp ain't come right out and say it, but he talked around the conversation a little. Keanu let me know. I fucked her years ago, though. My brother looked at me with so much disappointment in his eyes. You a dirty ass nigga, man, he told me. Even though I knew he didn't want to sit on that messy ass couch, he ended up taking a seat because that was the kind of news that forced you to have to sit down on your ass and just process the shit. Kato knew this, he asked, and I laughed at that question. Come on, man. You think I would be sitting here today if Kato knew about me fucking Sade? This shit may sound weird as hell, but it's a strong possibility that his ass knew. You know the kind of weird, calculated ass nigga Kato was. One thing about our brother, he was gonna find out some shit and he would sit on the information for years before he said anything about it. Think about the fact that nowhere in his will did he leave me and you with nothing when it came to the business. He just had our asses as fucking members of this shit. It's so many other titles that he could have given us, but he chose not to. Me and you used to be thick as thieves, so he probably thought I knew about you fucking Sade. That's probably why he didn't leave our asses with shit, Keanu said. Wow, I ain't even think about that. I really didn't think about that, y'all. I laughed because that was the dumbest theory I'd ever heard in my fucking life. That's some bullshit, nigga. You know as well as I do that if Kato even felt like I fucked Sade, he would have put a hole in me. You thinking too deep into it. That nigga didn't pass the throne to us because he was simply blinded by pussy to the point that he chose to overlook his brothers. Ain't no way around that shit, I said, and he just shook his head. That ain't even the worst of the damage, though. I feel like Cody might be my son. All right, nigga, chill out on whatever the fuck you smoking. We all know that nigga don't belong to you, Keanu said, quickly dismissing that shit. The nigga look just like me, I defended my argument. Nigga, and so does everybody else in the family. Our genes are fucking strong. Everybody looks like everybody in this damn family. You think because you and that nigga right with y'all left hand, that means he's your son? Come on, bruh. That nigga is every bit of Kato. Cody reminds me of how Kato used to act in his younger years. They nonchalant as fuck, but they'll pop off when they need to. On top of that, Sade is calculating just like her fucking husband. I could bet my last dollar she snuck and did a DNA test, Keanu said, before standing up from the couch. I swear this nigga dick ride was so fucking bad and I wanted to tell him that, but those were fighting words. We would have been in that bitch moving furniture, so I just kept that shit to myself. What's your plan, man? He asked. I'm about to get my shit together, start over fresh, form my own fucking empire, get my own plug, and I'm gonna do everything I was supposed to do with my own company that Kato didn't think a nigga was capable of doing, I confidently said. Kyle, you don't think it's time to wrap this shit up, man? We done ran our course with this hustling shit. We ain't young no more like our nephews. We've been hustling for well over 30 years. It's time to sit the fuck back and just enjoy life. I already had a conversation with corporate a few days ago, telling him that as soon as all this shit is over with these BB niggas, I want out. I don't find pleasure in this shit anymore. I would feel like you would think the same. Why would I, Keanu? Pops used to say that we don't walk away from the game until them niggas kill us or them crackers throw us in jail. I felt the need to remind him because it seemed that he'd forgotten. Keanu didn't even say anything after that shit. He just looked at me one last time and walked out of the apartment. There was something about the look that he'd given me. He stared at me like he felt it would be one of his last times looking at me. Like he knew that death or some bad shit was just around the corner waiting for my ass. Right now, I was down on my dick with no plug, no team, no nothing, but it wouldn't be that way for long. I had the money to put up to get some work, and when it came to getting a crew, I just had to get my ass out there in the field and find some niggas. During this process, I could only hope and pray that Kyrie was on board with me. That shit would make me feel some kind of way if he decided to mend shit with corporate and make money with the enemy when he could work alongside me and make money with me. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, Lord, have mercy. All right, y'all. That's it. All right. So this was fun. I really appreciate y'all listening to me read out loud, and I hope I left you feeling better than you were when you got here. Like, seriously, y'all. And then we'll do some more of the book tomorrow. But right now, child, I need to go watch BMF with my bitches. I got to do that because y'all don't even understand, huh, T? Oh, I didn't even see this, child.
Here comes the money.
Here we go. Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Y'all know y'all be clowning my ass. Thank you for the tip, Kaylin. She said, get you a tornado tea tonight, auntie. It's Tokyo tea, goddammit. Goddammit, Kathleen. It's called Tokyo tea, girl. And eels. All right. About to do that, child. As soon as I fix my fucking plate. I know you lying. Fix my fucking plate and head over yonder. Child, listen, I know you lying. All right, so listen, y'all. I had a good time. I really did. Thank you, Love Jones, for all of your hard work as a moderator, darling. I appreciate you, and I hope that you don't work too hard this evening, child, and hurry up and get your ass on home, all right? Listen, y'all. Y'all have a great night. Be safe, okay? Keep it cute, all right? But most of all, if you don't do shit else, please remember to salute your spirit and protect your peace. Not the tofu tea. Oh, my God. I'm adding everybody getting five tonight. Fuck out of here. All right. Until next time. I love y'all. And bye, y'all. I promise you, I will not be out in the backyard, Buck. I promise you, I won't.